Hello, hello everyone. I'm thrilled to welcome such a distinguished group of scholars, of architects, artists, and planners, as well as activists today to Colombia's GSAPP, to Housing the Majority, a conversation that was initiated to set in relation a number of cities from the perspective of housing in a rapidly urbanizing and globalizing world and under increasing social, political, infrastructural, and environmental pressures, to name but a few. The symposium brings together for the first time GSAPP's global network of Studio X directors to pose a common question across their various contexts. Their wealth and depth of knowledge, intelligence, as well as the collaborations and friendships they built over the past few years as they actively engaged to better understand their respective cities, was weaved together with the richness of voices from across campus and from our own faculty. This is also the second symposia benefiting from the generous ongoing collaboration with the global centers. As an introduction, I thought I would start by sharing what housing might mean in the imagination of the architect today, in a brief, wildly incomplete, personal, and unequivocally biased, the architect's bias, perspective on the term housing. In many ways, this day was designed to open up this term housing once more, as well as invite a notion of a majority, or at least to make more visible the many asymmetries we live in across the globe, as we try to outline new grounds and new terms for engagement. And so here it goes. Architecture has always dealt with shelter, from the nomadic tents, which inspired this year's Pritzker Prize winner, Fry Otto, to Logier's primitive hut, the idea of a unit of walls, floor, and roof able to negotiate the space between inside and outside, and between oneself and the world, preoccupied architects and shaped the discipline of architecture for as long as either one existed. With the advent of industrialization and the exodus away from the rural conditions to the urban centers, the movement from the single house to the thinking of collective housing emerges. For architects, imagining new forms of living and therefore housing, which could recast society, span the range from the utopian industrial, such as Garnier's Industrial City, or Ledoux's Saltworks at Chaux, to the utopian agrarian, such as with Fourier's Phalanstère, or Howard's Garden City. The end of World War II, in particular, enabled radical new ideas for living to house exploding populations, with the question of housing at the heart of the now maturing modernist movement. With Le Corbusier's famous unité d'habitation, a unit for living, ushering a brilliantly optimistic new era of light and air, as well as space and nature for everyone. These modernist investigations were not confined to Western Europe, as much exchange had already occurred after the First World War between Le Corbusier and the Russian constructivists' own early utopian speculations on collective living, many of which finally became real housing blocks deployed across Moscow. And as the fantastic exhibition Latin America in Construction demonstrates, currently on display at MoMA, housing experiments and radical new typologies were also burgeoning on their own terms across the South American continent, such as with the Proyecto Experimental de Vivienda in Previ in Peru. Elsewhere, such as in the Middle East, nations emerging from colonization were also embracing modernist models to announce their new independence, carve their path towards progress, and declare collective national projects as they aligned or refused to align themselves to either Eastern or Western bloc, as demonstrated by the choice of the architecture or the architect. Here, Nasser's urgent housing project at Helwan in Greater Cairo. Meanwhile, in the United States was developing its own housing strand in the form of the single family house to be deployed endlessly across the landscape, following new typological and production models that combined high standardization with high consumerism. here plans for a house in Levittown. Propelling the US economy towards global domination, here Aramco's expatriates compound in Dahran in Saudi Arabia. The American suburban kitchen was not only an economic weapon, it was also a cultural one, as demonstrated by the lively debate known as the kitchen talks between Nixon and Khrushchev around the merit of the two nations' opposing lifestyles. Back in Europe, a new horizontality was also taking hold, first in the form of the network, this is Toulouse Le Mirail by Candélis Diodis Woods in France, and here a Moroccan version by the same architects with vertical courtyards in the Honeycomb housing project in Casablanca. Further resisting and evolving Siam's orthodox modernism, Team 10 and Allison and Peter Smithson in particular turn to the North African Kasbah for inspiration as they articulate a new manifesto for the scale of the neighborhood, the street, and the courtyard through the typology of the mat building. A new type, part building, part city, which makes its way from the North African Kasbah to Berlin's Free University and back to Kuwait for the Smithson's master plan for a neighborhood in the city. In Japan, the metabolists also hybridize modernism's orthodoxies to mix not only uses but also systems, green farms, such as with Kurokawa's 1960 agricultural city, or fish farms, such as in Kikutake's ocean city, as housing becomes a living organism that connects individual bodies and lives to nested environmental scales beyond. For architects, to reimagine housing was often embraced not only as an act of imagination, but also sometimes as an act of resistance. After working for many years for the cosmopolitan Doxiades, as he develops new housing types for Baghdad, the Egyptian Hassan Fathi launches his architecture for the poor with a renewed commitment to local craft, empowering the Egyptian peasant to make his own home, and inventing a new language for Egyptian pride, a hybrid of vernacular building techniques with modern starkness and volumes. Here, the new Gourna village. Another resistance strand takes the form of ridding oneself of architects altogether, as Rudofsky traces housing and shelter as architecture without architects in the 1964 exhibit he curates at MoMA. Okay. Here, the Chinese Lewis belts. But the architects are not. Okay, for the benefit of the interpreter, I will speak slower. But the architects are not excluded for long, and soon invited back at MoMA in the museum's 1967 The New City: Architecture and Urban Renewal under Arthur Drexel, and featuring proposals by architects such as Eisenman and Graves. In 1972, with a resounding abruptness, decades of conversations and exchanges across cities and countries are silenced by the resounding demolition of Pruitt-Igoe. With every building block hitting the dust, so do the many dreams of housing as a site of imagination and of action for architects and architecture engaged in thinking, designing, and building a better and more equitable future. Instead, housing becomes a taboo word, a problem to be solved, a site to be avoided. This is from the Bio Hypothesis in 2011. And yet, and despite quite a strong disengagement with the real, schools and cultural institutions periodically attempt to reconnect architecture and housing. Here at Columbia in particular, starting in 1974, is a new engagement with the question of housing, as demonstrated by the retrospective exhibitions on the fourth floor. No longer merely a modernist function of the need for shelter, housing is seen as a lens through which to engage the complex new global patterns and transformations impacting cities and suburbs, bringing forth the tense social and environmental concerns that animated the early 70s. Outside of speculative explorations, such as Site's 1981 high-rise of homes, a palpable disengagement is felt throughout the 80s and 90s within both the discipline and architectural practices, at least in the US. Faced with rapid, uncontrolled urbanization and with a revived sense of engagement, the past decade has seen a renewed interest from architects in this question of housing, with pioneering new interventions and forms of practice, such as with Teddy Cruz's housing urbanism made of waste at the San Diego-Tijuana border, as well as through a series of important exhibitions, amongst them In the Desert of Modernity, curated by Marion von Osten at the Haus der Kulturen, der Welt, in 2008, Teddy Cruz's practice of encroachment from the global border to the border neighborhood at the Park Foundation in 2008, Big's exhibition at Storefront for Art and Architecture, also in 2008, curated by Joseph Grima, and MoMA's home delivery, Fabricating the Modern Dwelling, curated by Barry Bergdahl and Peter Christensen that same year. With further intensification, the recent foreclosure crisis brings the still too often exoticized there, the slum, the informal, right here, revealing deep fissures in our own ability or even desire to house equitably. Damon Rich's Red Line Housing Crisis Learning Center at the Queen's Museum in 2009 is one of the first exhibitions. The Buell Center and MoMA collaborate in 2011 on Foreclosed, Rehousing the American Dream. It's co-curated by Reinhold Martin and Barry Bergdahl. Urban Think Tank as Tori David, Gran Horizonte, is displayed to wide acclaim in 2012 at the Venice Architectural Biennale. House Housing, An Untimely History of Architecture and Real Estate, also from the Buell Center, goes to Venice in 2014. In Venice as well, this past summer, Jean-Louis Cohen's Modernity, Promise or Menace is at the French Pavilion, and FATS, Clockwork Jerusalem, all are kind of recent explorations of the question of housing. The most recent, closest one to us is, in fact, MoMA's Uneven Growth, Tactical Urbanism for Expanding Megacities, to which gave the idea of this conference as a kind of foil to the exhibitions. These exhibitions and early interventions are building up to further re-engagement through building as well. Lacaton Vassal, for example's use of an existing framework in La Tour Bois Le Petre, or Aravena's Quinta Monroe Housing, which provides half of the frame. And the new embrace of the notion of a micro unit in Seoul with single speed design sung by micro housing, or our own and architects teaching here at GSAPP's interpretation in New York, which is currently under construction. And so, unpacking this notion of housing, its multiple meanings, differing contexts, and similar resulting conditions, as well as the notion of who gets to be housed and how, here and elsewhere, we will move beyond the imagination of the architect, at times to contextualize and at other to counteract it, with panels and discussions which will explore the politics of housing, questions of representation, of governance, and finally, of form. And with special thanks to our keynote speaker tonight, David Sims, who is joining us from Cairo via Los Angeles. And so today, our goal really will be to try to redefine the terms of the debate in the face of soaring inequality and attempt to uncover new possible points of entry to the difficult humanitarian and maybe even architectural, again, challenge of either housing the majority or, as David Sims may polemically pose to us, letting the majority house itself. Thank you. And now a few words from the president of the Global Center, Safwan Masri, with whom we collaborated. He can't be here today, but has recorded a few words of welcome. So welcome.
This conference is the outcome of a true partnership among the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation under the able and committed leadership of my good friend Dean Aman Andravas and Studio X Aman, Istanbul, Mumbai, Johannesburg, and Rio de Janeiro, and the Columbia Global Centers. Following our very successful collaboration on last semester's conference, Architecture and Presentation, the Arab City, we are thrilled to continue and expand this interdisciplinary and global conversation on the pressing questions we are facing in the world today. The question of housing and shelter, which the Architecture School is taking very seriously through design studios and other seminars and research projects, is certainly a priority. Climate change, conflict, as well as real estate and capitalization interests are causing massive waves of displacement around the world. Understanding the effects of displacement on housing and how it is manifested in informal settlements and housing solutions is crucial for architecture education and practice. a critical engagement with such housing conditions from the perspectives of anthropologists, political theorists, urbanists, and designers is made possible through conversations and debates like the one here today. I understand that our speakers span from across campus and indeed from around the world, including New York, Istanbul, Rio de Janeiro, Mumbai, London, Johannesburg, and beyond. Bringing together voices from around the world that we can learn from and engage with, and to reflect on issues of global importance, such as the one being discussed and addressed today, is an identifying feature of both Studio X and the Columbia Global Centers networks. Both networks serve to benefit the larger community and continue to reinforce and complement one another. I wish you all a successful conference, and I'm sure you'll find the conversations to be both insightful and reflective. Thank you all for taking part, and I look forward to getting along the outcomes.
Thank you, Safwan. And on this note, Empo Metsipa, Studio X Director, Johannesburg, will launch the first panel. Welcome, Empo.
Thank you very much, Amal. Thank you, Global Centers, for the opportunity to be part of this conversation and also the first in the network of Studio X's around the world. I don't want to spend too much time talking because I've been told that I shouldn't. But the theme of this afternoon's panel is politics. And one of the questions that the Studio X directors asked when we were conceptualizing the content of the conference was, what are slums? Is the term slum self-evident? And how can it be understood historically, legally, and politically? And also, quite importantly, is how can this concept of the slum be thought of across multiple geographies that include not only cities in the developing world, but also in North America and Europe. It is in this context that I'm very happy to introduce our three panelists and our esteemed respondent, Professor Reinhold Martin. First, I would like to introduce Professor Maria Alice Cavallo. Professor Cavallo is a full professor in the Department of Social Sciences at the Pontifical Catholic University of Rio de Janeiro. She is both a historian and a sociologist, and the author and co-author of 9 books, 2 of which have received the National Library Foundation Award and the Association of Brazilian Magistrates Award. In 2009, Professor Cavallo was elected the president of the National Association for Research and Graduate Studies in Social Studies for the biennium 2009 to 2010. She has also been working as a consultant or evaluator of urban programs implemented by the Municipal Secretary of Housing since 1994. Today, she coordinates the Center of Studies and Projects of the City at PUC Rio, a laboratory for research and debate about Rio de Janeiro. Our second speaker comes from my hometown, Johannesburg. Claudia Gastau is a Mellon Postdoctoral Fellow at the University of the Witwatersrand in the Department of Anthropology. She received her PhD in anthropology from the University of Chicago in June 2014, and her dissertation titled Negotiated Settlements, Housing and the Aesthetics of Citizenship in Luanda, Angola, investigates the reshaping of citizenship during the post-conflict building boom in Angola's capital, Luanda. She's currently working on a book manuscript based on her dissertation project, as well as a second project that investigates the history and politics of unofficial economies in Luanda. Her work engages with urban studies, political anthropology, aesthetic theory, and studies in material culture. Our final panelist, David Madden, is an assistant professor in the Department of Sociology at the London School of Economics, and he teaches in the LSE Cities program. Professor Madden's work focuses on urban studies, political sociology, and social theory. He has conducted ethnographic and historical research in New York, London, and elsewhere, addressing topics including public housing, public space, the politics of urban development, gentrification, and planetary urbanization. Professor Madden has previously taught at Columbia University, New York University, and Bard College, and he holds a PhD in sociology from Columbia University. So welcome back, Professor Madden. He's also a member of the editorial board of the journal City. And finally, Reinhold Martin is an associate professor in the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation at Columbia University. He directs the PhD program in architecture and the Temple Hoyne Buell Center for the Study of American Architecture. He is a member of Columbia's Institute of Comparative Literature and Society, as well as the Committee on Global Thought. Professor Martin is a founding co-editor of the journal Grey Room and has published widely on history and theory of modern and contemporary architecture. He is also the author of The Organizational Complex, Architecture, Media, and Corporate Space, Utopia's Ghost, Architecture, Postmodernism, Again, as well as co-author with Kadami Baji of Multinational City Architectural Itineraries. In 2012, Professor Martin co-curated with Barry Bergdahl Foreclosed, Rehousing the American Dream at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, for which he and Bergdahl also co-edited the exhibition catalog. Please join me in welcoming our first panel on politics. So Professor Carvalho, I think you are up next.
Very happy to stay here. I would like to thank all the coordinators of this conference, mentioning all the coordinators of this conference. Mentioning specifically Pedro Rivera from Brazil and Gavi Browning for the invitation and for providing the conditions that brought me here. It's an honor and a real pleasure to meet you all, speakers and responsers. Well, I don't speak English, and we have only a few minutes to expose our subject. So I apologize, but I'm going to read a little paper in this first round. Talking about favelas in an epistemological and political way is a title that sounds pretentious, but the message is quite simple, and it was suggested by the questions that are at program. What are slums? Is the term slum self-evident? And so on. Okay, I don't believe that today, slums, favelas, and other similar realities still can be described or thought as an interstitial phenomenon of modern societies, like they were originally. And this is not just because of the scale of the slums today. This is not a question of scale. Actually, the slums have ceased to occupy an interstitial place in contemporary societies for reasons which I shall mention later. In few words, there is an impressive change in the morphology of cities, and this change imposes a new approach in both the conceptual and political levels. The simple idea will be stressed in the next 12 minutes. It's obvious that my place of observation is Rio de Janeiro, and that I risk some generalizations, even knowing that every favela, every slum has their specificity. I'm testing with you some general assumptions about the contemporary cities and its challenge. In this case, I think some generalizations are necessary. Okay, as we know, the concept of slum is associated to the industrial or sociological cities. Yes, sociological city. Because both industry and sociology conform the urban world in 19th century. That world was unprecedented because it had two striking features that distinguish it from previous urban formations. The first feature is an institutionalized labor market, which meant the impossibility of living without salary. Since then, this has been the structuring principle of modern urban cities. The second feature was the transformation of the path in institutionalized streets, a space where anyone could build their homes, private equipment, or certainly the movement of others. So the street is the most specific institution of the modern city because it represents a generalized agreement about limits. Territorial limits in the first place, but also political and administrative limits. So we can say that wages, that means institutionalized gains, and sidewalks, that means institutionalized path, are faces of the sociological seeds that reveal the action of the state as economic and territorial organizer of them. The presence of slums in this frame is this evidence that there were interstitial areas in modern world that had not yet been captured by the dynamic of the state. Those slums were built by men and women who continued to obtain gains. A moment. Ah, okay. Who continued to obtain gains, not salaries, and living in territories not yet covered by the city. The word yet, in this context, is very important because it expresses the sociological belief in a complete universalization of the city. Where the state has played the role of defining the labor and land markets, the slums tended to remain as the anteroom, antecamera of the cities. Or better, slum is only the draft that will become city. The sociological legend of inclusion is more persuasive in this case, and therefore, the 9th century's urban form was more legitimated. But not always the state played this role. Historically, in Rio de Janeiro, for instance, the burst of the slums, favelas, coincided with the state building. So the weakness of the state has not been able to institutionalize nor the labor market or the urban space, and also hasn't been able to provide a massive and persuasive belief in inclusion. It was not a state that universalized the city yesterday and it still is not. Finally, the weakness of the state has produced a kind of inversion. The real city was historically the dysregulated city, and the modern city is the result of some projects and urbanistic effects to promote the organization of the city. The role of the architects in Rio is a political role, and they are very important actors of the democratization of the city. There is a strong dispute about Rio's urban morphology, as in the controversy about streets and in favela. Is the street a good thing? Not a good thing. So, to finish my presentation, the problem is how to understand the slums, favelas in Rio de Janeiro now. And I think that they can be understood like interstitial phenomenon. Now, I think it's the central phenomenon of a democratization of the city. And it's an important thing to think about. Thank you.
I'd like to welcome Claudia Gastra to come and present about her research in Luanda and the slum.
Let me just move this back here. I also just want to open just by thanking Gavin Browning and Mpoma Tsipa for inviting me. I'm really excited to be part of this conversation. I am not an architect, I'm an anthropologist, and so it's really great for me to kind of be in discussion with people outside of my discipline. So I'm going to be talking to you guys a bit about the idea of the slum in relation to what's very often thought about to be a counterpart for many people, which is some type of formal idealized city, and I'm going to do that through my work in Luanda, Angola. Okay, so I'm just going to start with this image. So the image up on the screen was taken in a settlement built by victims of slum demolitions in Luanda, Angola. Ironically, the sign slung across the corrugated iron house is in fact an advertisement for the very project, the rehabilitation of Luanda's upmarket leisure area, the Ilia, that people in the neighborhood were in fact forcibly removed to make way for. And so the writing across the sign reads, and I quote, "We support the revitalization of our Ilia." And so the possibility of someone who was violently moved appearing to be supporting the project that undergirds their removal is a very difficult thing to understand. And having not had the opportunity to in fact speak to the person who had found and lifted the banner, I of course could not know for sure that the statement was not entirely sarcastic, could very well have been. And yet, in my experience, it is precisely the ambiguity captured in the question of whether the resident is criticizing or praising the project that lies at the heart of recent negotiations of the meaning of the slum in many African countries, especially in the face of a growing trend of satellite city construction, which aims at the effacement of the slum. So the irony of the banner, after all, is only made clear through its juxtaposition with the corrugated iron house. So the term the slum has rightly been criticized for homogenizing a variety of diverse built forms and social circumstances, as well as stigmatizing those people who live in areas who become labeled as criminal or poor by their association with the slum. However, I'm going to argue that in some ways it's only actually by understanding how local notions of the term, and in the case of Luanda, the word musek is used a lot to describe slums, and the meanings and histories attached to those terms, that we can begin to understand the ambiguity of how urban residents are grappling with new urban projects, or even understand the grounds for imagining an urban future that in fact speaks to the majority of the population as opposed to trying to erase them. And so in order to get to this sort of politics of the slum and contemporary urbanism, as I said, I'm going to look at Luanda. Just some background. For those of you who are less familiar with the country, Angola is Africa's second largest oil producer and experienced 40 years of armed conflict from 1961 until 2002. So what began as an anti-colonial war morphed into a civil war, which then ended in 2002. And since the end of the war, Luanda, which is the capital of Angola, has been the site of multiple slum demolitions, which have been undertaken by state institutions and private investors, forcibly removing hundreds of thousands of people to make way for a hodgepodge of upscale real estate developments, infrastructural rehabilitation projects, and urban beautification programs. And that's the most well-known one, which is a satellite city built outside Luanda, known as Quilombo. So as a small elite gets rich of construction and speculation, a growing number of the urban population have been left homeless, landless, and angry. And that's basically their lot. So the antipathy of planners against slums is certainly not unique to Luanda, but has particular local discourses, as in any place, attached to it that are important to understanding what is at stake in slum demolition in the city. So in popular narratives encouraged by the states, slums, or as I said, as they are often referred to in Luanda, museks, are framed as the product of the war, blamed on the flood of internally displaced people into the city and the incapacity of the wartime state to cope with this influx. So this argument then portrays contemporary urban planning and forced removals as a reassertion of state presence done for the good of the population. At the same time, the slums or museks are also often described as, quote, anarchic, a nod to the assumed illegal status of their creation and the assumed illegal practices of their inhabitants. But if we were to stop here, we would miss the meaning of the slum to those who inhabit it. The musek as an imaginary within the space of the city, and with it, of course, the imaginations of cityness that might flow from there. For arguing the language of the slum, or in this case musek, must be discarded, misses the point that it is only one part of a relationship. So to rid ourselves of the slum, we would need to interrogate our idea of the ideal city. After all, I would argue that the terms which are used in Luanda, for example, which are cidade, meaning city, and musek, more or less meaning slum, in that part of the world almost exist as a latent grammar through which any part of the city, building, or person can be identified in relation to conversation and the objects and people around them on reference to another space. And so, for instance, there was at some point in the past, there were high-rises which were kind of overtaken by internally displaced people, and people started calling them vertical slums, which I know happens in other parts of the world. So rather than fixed points, I would argue that to a certain extent, there are relational and ideological means through which the city is apprehended. They also come loaded with contradictory connotations. The slum is both a site of disorder, precarity, and danger, as well as the location of a so-called authentic urban culture and the national liberation struggle. Slow down. Okay. Depending on the conversation, its inhabitants are both the people and criminals. But these ideological imaginaries have real consequences in the world. And it is through understanding the slum, not just as a morphological form of the built environment, but as a socially shared concrete abstraction, that we can begin to pick at the politics of slumness and cityness. And so the importance of understanding the grounded social imaginaries of the slum as opposed to moving into technical language was emphasized to me in my discussions with demolition victims in Luanda. And I'm sure, as many of you know, a substantial body of research has indicated that auto-construction, i.e. building your house yourself, is central to the production of urban citizenship in the contemporary world. So James Halston most famously describes auto-constructors as the, quote, modern pioneers of city building. And pushing the edge of the city out ever further, they create the city, in the process claiming rights to it. In Luanda, this is very much the case for people who live in what some might call the slum. So during the war and into the present, the auto-constructed house became the prime index of financial stability and urban status. One belonged to the city if one had a house. Even if public services were almost non-existent and food was scarce, a person belonged as a recognized individual in a substantive sense, even if they lived in what we might call a slum. So this has begun to change, as I indicated, in the post-conflict era, as the government's public embrace of housing projects sourced from China, South Africa, and Brazil has led to auto-constructed houses being increasingly seen as a blight, as risky rather than stable in popular discourse. This is not to say that people were not disparaging of them before, or that people have not previously demanded better living conditions. It is, however, to track how the transformation of imaginaries of slum versus city, musek versus cidade in this case, has altered everyday notions of what is required to belong, to be a citizen, indicating how key it is to understand both the economic and material conditions of slum construction, but also the imaginaries of aesthetics and politics that accompany them. And so perhaps the most extreme version, and I'm going to again give you an example, of urban residents' sense of relationship between imaginations of city, slum, aesthetics, and belonging, emerge in discussions with residents of an area I'm going to call Vamos Andar, which means let's walk. It's a pseudonym, as they tried to decide how to move forward after having waited 8 years to be rehoused after a slum demolition. And so one of the things they decided to do, because they'd been living in corrugated iron houses, was start building in cement block, which until recently had been the most solid indication of urban permanence for the poor. For years, they had been living in the corrugated iron houses next to the area from which they had been displaced. They had avoided building in cement block because they had hoped to be rehoused, but also because they feared that the powerful signal of permanence that building in cement indexed would provoke the wrath of authorities and lead to another demolition. However, their desperateness of their condition had now trumped their fears. And so one of the neighborhood residents explained to me in these terms why he thought they needed to build in cement block. And so he said, quote, we, that is the people, thought to do it in this manner of reconstructing and urbanizing the neighborhood so that we could pressure the government to give us a response. And if the government doesn't respond, then God willing, we will build and remain here until the end. And it's interesting to note that their area had, in fact, not been threatened with demolition in a while, but there was a real fear, there was a run-up to the election, that if they didn't build in cement block, kind of create a new form of slum prior to the election, if the government came afterwards and knocked it down, there wouldn't be much resistance from the public because of the substantive perceived difference in material between a corrugated iron house versus a cement block house. And so building in cement block was a confrontational means of seeing if developers had given up their ambitions for the neighborhood. But even as they were discussing how they're trying to force a confrontation, in fact, the whole language of kind of the ideal city had seeped into the way that they were planning to build. Because they were not just going to rebuild, they were planning to sort of recycle the ideals of good urbanism, of good cityness that have become so predominant in Luanda. And so Georges, one of the members of the residence committee, showed me the neighborhood plan that they put together. Okay, and that's what the residents came up as the ideal plan for a neighborhood. Okay, and so obviously to say that it's grid-like would be a euphemism. So what had happened is they basically tried to adopt the point of view of the state, carefully laying out grid-like streets, making a space for a soccer field, a space for a church, a space for a marketplace, and an office for the residence committee, which are kind of the unofficial governance units. So Georges explained that the neighborhood was going to mimic the aesthetic sensibilities of their wealthy neighbors, like a wealthier neighborhood which was next to them, and the demands of the state for, quote, organizations. In fact, his main point was that they were going to put walls around all of the houses. And so what he said to me was, they, the government, normally say that we build without logic, but with a wall, a house looks different. So the next day, Samuel, another member of the neighborhood, explained that they were going to build in a standardized way because they did not want their wealthy neighborhood in the state middle-class project next door to think that they were, quote, a messy neighborhood. This, he was hopeful, would mean that any possible problems, such as demolition, would be avoided. So he argued, again, using the language of the state, that their project was a form of state-directed auto-construction because the layout of the neighborhood meant that access to roads and services would not be blocked. In this way, he said, they would be no different to what he referred to as the, quote, luxury slum next door, which was an area where the state had laid out plots in the 90s and sold them to an emerging middle class. So as residents spoke of their plans, it became clear that they were evoking a material aesthetic notion of what legality was based upon, what the city was based upon, but also recognizing a shift in the politics of citizenship in the city. Their cement block houses would no longer have been enough in themselves. They had to be sculpted to a certain ideal of cityness, a certain imagination of the urban that appeared legitimate in order to make a claim on the city. So the tussles between the imagination of slum and city were having substantial effects on the form and appearance of the slum, something which could only be understood if one engaged with not only the clear need to demand land and housing rights, but on the grounded histories of understanding the position of the slum, the politics of materiality, and struggles over aesthetics that are inherent to a term such as slum. Ordinary urban inhabitants understand these connotations both the liberatory and oppressive connotations very well, and build cities in conversation with them. So the point then has been to show not only that the slum is both a space and an imaginary rooted in histories of a specific place, but also that it is constantly in conversation and in struggle with its idealized other, the planned wealthy city. As urban planning, at least in many African countries, seems to lean ever more towards the kind of latter idealized city rather than the slum, it does us no good to shy away from the negative connotations of discussions of the slum in the hope that doing so will somehow point to a more equal urban future. Auto-construction might produce the grounds for citizenship, but we will not understand the idioms through which these forms of belonging are expressed, the kinds of built environments that are considered inclusive, nor the political repercussions of building new cities if we do not understand the slum in relation to larger urban imaginaries, more specifically its flip side, the city. So to interrogate and critique the city then, we don't need to celebrate the slum, but we do need to understand it as more than simply informal, but rather as a place where political subjectivities are crafted in relation to histories, materials, aesthetics, and experiences that constantly negotiate the notion of slum as negation and slum as affirmation of belonging. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Claudia, for a phenomenal presentation on construction of or production of subjectivities in Luanda, and also unpacking and complicating the term slum to considerations of aesthetics and materiality. Our next speaker is somebody who has a slightly different position on the subject than you do, and I would like to welcome David Madden to the podium. Oh, there you are.
Thank you. Thanks for having me here. It's great to be back at Columbia. I want to start with a few of the many images that structure the concept of the slum for us. From the birth of the slum in the 19th century to the so-called return of the slum across the world today, there's a powerful set of visual and conceptual tropes through which we understand or misunderstand housing and the spatialization of urban inequality. And now that the slum is back on the agenda of scholars, governments, NGOs, international consultants, global corporations, and others, I think we really need to think critically about the category of the slum, what this category means, what it does for our understanding of housing and urbanization. And there's, I think there's an interesting question also of the sort of politics of translation, which sort of connects to your paper as well. But so it's the question of the ontology of the slum, and I think the broadest way to pose this question is, do slums exist? Now, no one doubts the existence of spaces of poverty, of social violence, of substandard housing, of auto-constructed infrastructure. The question is whether or not they're adequately understood using the category of slum. And the question is there some essential link between all these spaces which historically and in the present have been called slums, from Clerkenwell and the Five Points in the 19th century to the spaces across the globe today? And so I think we need to think about what this conceptual frame slum does for us. You know, why slum as opposed to other ways of understanding these spaces? What does this category do for our conception of housing and the city? Whom does it empower and what does it erase? I think broadly speaking, we can say there are sort of two approaches to the ontology of the slum. The sort of positivist understanding of the slum would have it that the slum is a natural kind of urban space that has a spontaneous reality independent of any observation of it. So here's a quote from Charles Stokes, who says that what is slum in the city is of spontaneous origin. And using a very common metaphor when people talk about slums, he says they're like cancer. They just sort of appear and grow within the city, and hence they need to be fought as well. But I think we would do well to follow more critical accounts of the slum, that see them as ideational and conceptual as well as physical constructs. So Alan Gilbert is a major scholar of these issues, and he says slums are relational and as much a figment of the mind as a physical construct. So sort of taking this point, I think we need to see the category of slum itself as a sociological object that needs to be understood in its own right and in relation to the spaces to which it refers. So we need to sort of understand what this category is doing for us. It goes without saying, this is a very sort of broad historical and geographical discussion that I'm presenting here. And I mean, there's obviously quite a lot of local variation. In fact, my point is that the category itself erases a lot of that local variation. But if there's one sort of major point I want to add to our discussion, it's that the category of slum is a distortion. It is an ideological representation of the very real process of urban dispossession. And dispossession, obviously, is a very broad term in itself and a multiscalar phenomenon. So the dispossessions that produce these spaces, which we call slums, occur on many different scales, on the urban scale, on the regional scale. A lot of the people who are living in these spaces were dispossessed from hinterland or rural spaces, and on the global scale as well. But we can locate the origin of the concept of slum in the social distance and inequality between the subjects and objects of urban knowledge. So slum is prototypically a category produced by strangers, and it's prototypically a category produced by relatively elite and privileged strangers traveling to dispossessed urban spaces and representing them in their own visual and conceptual languages, generally for their own ends, which is, again, not to say that there aren't cases when residents of dispossessed areas take on the concept of slum and twist it or try to transform it. But for the most part, it is the discourse of elite outsiders. And a cheeky way to put this, I think, would be that capitalist urbanization produces spaces of dispossession, but slumming produces the slum, and it produces the slum as an ideological artifact. And by that term, I mean a set of political, economic, social, scientific, literary, and touristic practices, I probably should have added architectural practices that produce this image of the slum which we have. So, as I said, it is inherently an outsider's way to talk about dispossessed urban areas, and it is, in most usages, a colonial term or a neo-colonial term, even if the colonies that it's representing are internal colonies. So one of the ways that we can sort of see the ideological nature of the category of slum is that from the 19th century to the present, the category itself has been quite stable, and the set of associations that institutions and actors bring to this category have been relatively stable, even though there's been this history of massive transformations in the process of urbanization. So slums are always said to be marked by a few things. They're always said to be marked by social disorganization, the sort of idea that the sociality of so-called slum dwellers, and that the term slum dwellers itself is also a sort of 19th century term that's recently been rehabilitated. But the idea is that the sort of social networks and social worlds of slum dwellers are always somehow in shambles. There's always said to be some sort of connection between material degradation and the degradation of consciousness. And the 19th century version of this was this language of sort of moral degeneracy. And now people still talk about slums of despair. There's just this sense that so-called slum dwellers have been sort of mentally and culturally marked by their residence in the slum. Slums are always seen as diverse spaces, but in contrast to the largely positive valuation of cosmopolitanism in most of the other spaces of the city, it's seen as the sort of pathetic cosmopolitanism, as a sign of social disorganization rather than as a resource. They are seen as functionally interchangeable, and many representations of the slum sort of regard these as globally identical spaces, and as spaces that don't have the spatial differentiation and specialization that other urban spaces possess. And finally, from fear of communism and fear of anarchism, to the war on terrorism, the slum is always imagined as a sort of looming political threat and as a fifth column within the city and nation. So my claim is that no matter what is really happening in these dispossessed spaces, the category of the slum brings these associations to it. Now, it's very easy to sort of see the ideology of the slum when you look at slightly older sources. So in London, much of the sort of slum discourse was formed by doctors and medical personnel. And so here you can clearly see this language about moral and social degradation, which has always been central to the concept of slum. But it was not just a specialized discourse in medicine and social work. You can find talk about the slum everywhere. So the New York Times in the 30s and 40s is filled with articles about slums as places of a strange conglomeration of peoples and cultures, where the poor are always huddling together. And this image of huddling masses is also always very, very, very central to the idea of the slum. And if you look at this language, color, charm, esoteric quaintness, the things one goes abroad to discover are here, obscured by their very nearness. This is very close to a lot of the sort of patronizing discourse that you have about the slums today in the sort of global urbanist and development world. Here's another example of a social worker who has gone into the slums of London. Well, this didn't work out quite so well, but and she says that she doesn't even she won't even refer to it as a name. She just refers to this area as wreckage, and she says it's a social outrage, a crime before God, that such conditions as the slum conditions should exist in a Christian country in an empire famed for justice and fair dealing to all men. Which is not the first thing that comes to mind for everyone discussing the British Empire, but it's this sense that there's this sort of slum mind, and that part of the reasons that we should be concerned about slums is because they're a sort of political, social, and biological threat to the rest of the city. The language today is, in some cases, updated, but I think that the ideology of the slum remains essentially similar. So slums are still seen as caught between hope and despair, as opposed to seen as the product of the same process of capitalist urbanization, which leads to massive agglomerations of wealth for some. Slums are still seen as sort of spreading like a disease, and still seen as this essentially undifferentiated substance. I mean, if you look at this map, you would think that a good half of Africa is between 81% and 100% slum. Slums are still seen to be breeding various political evils. And the verb breeding is obviously so frequently attached to the slum, but never to privileged spaces. So there's this entire urban imaginary that is connected to the idea of slum. And I think for most users of the concept of slum, to use it is to engage in this kind of territorial stigmatization and spatial fetishism. So what does the category of slum do for those who deploy it? And I think it's clear that most usages of the concept of slum promote some projects and some agendas and undermine others. So I think it is inherently connected to displacement and the eliminationist agenda. If slums are understood as moral, political, and biological threats, then they need to be eliminated. And you still see this sort of usage of slums across the world. I mean, here's one example from a document from the government of Nairobi, and they're saying the displacement of slums is crucial to the city's rebranding strategy. It needs to be sort of excised in order to enable the city to become a sort of properly global city. But for others, the slum and the need to eliminate them is an investment opportunity. And I think, again, the sense that we have about the reality of these spaces sort of legitimizes profit-making from their elimination. And as well, since the political agency of the urban dispossessed is never recognized or acknowledged, the ideology of the slum justifies technocratic projects and technocratic expertise in response to these areas. And it's important to say that social movements that are led by the dispossessed themselves, in many cases, are not only contesting inequity, but are also contesting the concept of the slum. So this is from a press release from Abalali Basim Jondolo, which is a group that I'm sure many of us are familiar with. And they're saying, the word slum makes it sound like the places where poor people live are a problem that must be cleared away because there's something wrong with poor people. But it does not admit that the poor have been made poor by the same history of theft and exploitation that made the rich to be rich. So this is an example of sort of a critical politics of urban dispossession that is contesting the categories that people use in order to understand it. And in my fieldwork in New York and London, I encountered many examples of housing organizers and political actors who were completely rejecting this concept of slum, even though governments and developers were trying to mobilize it to justify their removal. So a few words towards conclusions. I think that the point is clearly not to sort of police the language that scholars use. I think rather the point is to think critically about the concepts and categories that we do use. And I actually think Claudia and I are definitely in agreement about that. But I do think that we should jettison the category of slum as a category of analysis, which is not to say that we can't and shouldn't recognize it as an important category of practice, but we need to have some sort of critical distance from it in order to see what it does in the urbanization process. So I think instead we should think about these slums as spaces of dispossession and think about the process of dispossession that forms them. So this would be a sort of reflexive critique of categories like slum and a reflexive critique of urban knowledge. And the sort of hope is that such a reflexive critique of categories like slum can help us understand the role of the state and of other institutions in bolstering an unequal global urban world and hopefully help us find ways to change it. So thank you.
Thank you very much, David, I would like to invite our speakers to please take a seat at the table in front before we have a response from Reinhold Martin. So I think you're seated over there. Yeah.
Do we do anything? No. All right, well, thank you. Thank you to all and welcome. I'll try to speak slowly, and I won't speak much, because I think there's much to discuss. It's quite interesting to begin this conference, I think, in a sense, with the questions that you've all raised. I would say it's not typical in a conference in this room. So, you know, that's a compliment, and I think it starts us off very well because it starts us in a place that I think may be a little less familiar and maybe even a little uncomfortable for the discourse and the set of disciplines that are more typically represented here. But you know, starting with the frame again, just kind of spending a little bit of time with the frame, I wanted to raise the question of kind of acknowledge and mark the title of the conference and specifically the word majority, the presence of the word majority in the conference, in relation to a kind of, let's say, a code word, a performative that does some of the work also that a number of you have suggested that the term slum does, that to some extent I think conditions this discussion, which is the word and the performative called urbanization. So in other words, we're familiar, and it's been said many times in this room, I must say, I've heard it said many times, with the story that goes like something like this: half the world's population lives in cities. And then there are some maps or diagrams on the screen. You guys know this, right? And I'm yet to this day, I've never heard anybody yet ask in the room, like, what about the other half? But let's just say, okay. In some sense, this is what we're speaking about. It's well known now that even on its own terms, the terms of the United Nations and a certain kind of statistical governmentality, this statement is more or less factually wrong. This is one way in which we could follow some of the suggestions and also refer to this as ideological. I'm saying performative in the sense of trying to mark the work that statement is doing. And I do think that it's doing some of, some work in tandem and in sort of collaboration with the word slum. But one of the things that clearly it's doing, and even in critical discourse around urbanization, is, as it were, silencing. It's the work of silencing, more than simply, in a sense, excluding, which almost sounds polite in this context, but more violently and more demonstratively, preventing us from hearing and in a sense engaging what we could call the real, which is to say the actuality of history. I mean, what really is happening? I'm just putting it very sort of straightforwardly. And what we're seeing when we're looking at the photos that you're showing us, and in a sense digesting the facts that you're offering us, and the terms, including the call, the calls made in I say really across the board, by Maria, but Claudia and David, to rethink our terms, the term slum and street. That we could add space to this, which is again another one of these that lies a bit behind in the background. Okay, so that's one thing, just to think what work this category of urbanization is doing in relation to these other categories that we are discussing. I also have to say that from the point of view of housing the majority and so on, and the rural to urban dynamics that Amal mentioned and that a number of you have pointed out, that to some extent have in effect produced the spaces that we're thinking about, what would Engels say? I mean, what really is the housing question? Really, seriously, what is the housing question today? I mean, this is I think it's something we must do, and I think I know we're not the only ones doing it. That's a good sign that there's been a lot of conferences and publications and discussion around this issue. Yes, he would say this is a form of dispossession what we're looking at. It also when you put Engels together with the discourse and practice of the state as analyzed by someone like Michel Foucault or many thinkers today, one would also recognize in the moralization, in the doctors, and we could say today the architects and the planners and the experts, the specialists entering these spaces, we could say that's power, that's how it works. So to turn this into a question to kind of ponder a bit, what perhaps then is the relation between dispossession and power, both in a sense manifest state power, but also and much more in a sense visibly, one can say, I'm thinking of the image that Claudia showed at the very beginning, the monster called the market as an instrument of the state, or vice versa, the state as the executive committee of the bourgeoisie, and so on. So what's happening here? What are we really witnessing, and what are we what are we thinking in relation to what we're witnessing? One more little observation, general observation about the frame. I don't know how many times I've shown that Pruitt-Igoe image, and I'm all showed it again. And it's I think it's very important for us to remember the violence of that image and the pleasure that has been taken by so many in watching that image over and over again and reprinting it and republicizing it. And one of the things you notice in the background, sometimes it's cropped differently, but you had a good one. You see the Saarinen Arch, the Jefferson Memorial Arch, just kind of looming over the background, the St. Louis Arch, right? A monument to manifest destiny. Designed by a very well-known architect, by the way, you know. And so in this sort of American master narrative in which that image plays, continues to play and replay, there is, in the juxtaposition, let's say, of the you know, building being demolished and the arch in the background, a structuring imaginary. Let's say it even approaches something what Raymond Williams called a structure of feeling. And in other words, it's not just something that's sort of, as it were, formulated rationally. It's a way of feeling space. And which wants to separate that space out into the metropolitan, i.e. St. Louis, i.e. Housing, urban renewal, social housing, and so on, and the pastoral in the American sense, i.e. Jefferson. And really it's our job to see these things together, to understand what it means, what modes of spatial practice, what forms of dispossession, put those things together and uncannily repeat those that conjunction in photographs and things like that, such that the phenomena that we're grappling with in this panel exist and present themselves. So I'm basically asking us to think these spaces together, to think the geographies together, the rural and the urban, to put it in the more classical terms, and move them around and move the relation around as we discuss this, because in that sense, the housing question is, after all, a question of how we share this planet. So more specifically, I mean, I think we have quite a lot to talk about, specifically in terms of the wonderful observations and analyses that you've offered us. And so I'm not going to recapitulate the talks or the points that have been made. I think what we can do maybe is think a little bit about this term. You've all asked us to do this, so let's start there. And I'm asking you essentially if the frame that I've tried to just now sketch around it, the frame that in a sense wants to at least bracket or postpone the performativity of the term urbanization, and to just look at history happening. What kind of work then in that context does slum, barrio, museca, favela, and so on, and specifically also I'm asking to you maybe to mark the differences, linguistic, cultural, sociological, and historical. So I don't know. Do you want to start since we're here?
In Portuguese.
Yes, I know. Let's do it in Portuguese. We have your turn. She also speaks Portuguese, so she'll help. Do you want
to? Eu penso que o esforço para definir slum, favela e termos similares tem sido no sentido de aprisioná-los num frame, numa moldura social. É o tema da carência.
I think that the effort to define slums or favelas is similar to imprisoning the concept into a frame.
No frame social, a consequência política é a provisão de casas.
in a social frame, the political consequence is the provision of housing.
Mas, do ponto de vista político, slum ou favela é uma outra coisa e a consequência política é a provisão de cidade.
But from a political point of view, slum is something else, and the political consequence is the provision of a city.
O exemplo que eu dou é o programa Minha Casa Minha Vida, no Rio de Janeiro, que é um programa federal de habitação, de construção de habitação popular.
The example that I cite is the My House, My Life program in Rio de Janeiro, which is a federal program to provide housing.
É um programa de favorecimento social que constrói casas muito longe, muito afastadas e muito desprovidas de cidade. Não há nenhum bem de cidadania que essas casas prevejam. Nem escola, nem saúde, nem mobilidade, nem transporte público.
And these areas are, the houses are built in very far away areas, which are, do not have the resources that the city offers, such as schools, health, mobility, and urban transportation.
Então, o esforço, eu penso, é de trazer o tema da favela para uma chave política.
So I think the effort is to bring the theme of slums into a political point of view.
Yeah. E pensar de que maneira a ideia de participação e organização, de liberdade, não igualdade apenas, pode ser fixado como um bem universal.
And the thought that the idea of participation, of freedom, not just equality, is required.
Freedom, de uma perspectiva política, significa um assento participativo e democrático da maioria da população.
Freedom, from a political point of view, is to have a seat in the political and democratic process.
Eu acho que é esse o ponto, né? Porque historicamente ele tem consequências, ele foi construído, né? E produz consequências políticas que precisam ser redimensionadas.
Historically, it is it has political consequences that need to be redefined.
Agora, para pensar, por último, finalizando, um quadro mais geral que simplesmente o do Brasil e o do Rio de Janeiro.
And in closing, the, in a more general fashion, what's happening in Brazil and Rio de Janeiro?
Eu penso que é a ideia de conceito, os conceitos que normalmente são usados para discussão de cidades e de favelas são conceitos que pressupõem um Estado que é diferente dos Estados pós-coloniais.
The concepts that are normally used to discuss cities and slums are concepts that
o conceito de cidade e slum é diferente, é pensado juntamente com o Estado, que é distinto das formações pós-coloniais.
It is a concept that is thought together with the state in a post-colonial context.
Okay. You know, quickly before we, I wanted to see what others say. I'm trying to draw out a little bit the relation, or non-relation perhaps, between, as it were, the enunciation, like how, you know, speech in a context, the use of a word, you know, on behalf of a particular state policy like the Minha Casa Minha Vida, or or on behalf of profit, or on behalf of you know, some moral program. So in other words, if we think that this problem of the performative, how can we think this problem in relation to the other element that I was trying to kind of draw out here, the dynamic of as it were, dispossession and what you called socialization, the sort of training of subjects, often through the state, not always, as part of, integrally part of their exploitation, right? So you know, it seems that's what I'm trying to put. So on the one hand, we have the language of the state, the sort of association, perhaps, or rethinking of this. I think I hear you say. As a means, or a sort of a marking out a street, in a sense, metaphorically, mm-hmm. That leads to a more just and equitable democratic polity. And yet, it seems, and I think we've seen evidence in the other, you know, from Claudia and David. That it seems also that what's going on here in this socialization is in a sense training into a certain subjectivity, not you know univocally or without sort of resistance or alterity, but you know with force, let's say. Right? Go ahead, either one.
Sure. Let me just. Is working?
Thanks. I mean, the question is a huge one.
No, I was thinking about, you made these points.
No, but I mean, look, I think actually the issue of bracketing the notion of urbanization is really key here. And if I think especially if you look at the African context, all the research, the early research done, etc., immediately sets up this notion of kind of an ideal city towards which people yeah. move, become certain types of subjects. And the real challenge is, if you get rid of that teleology, what are the spaces that we're confronted with? And I think that's one of the very key challenges in thinking through a space like the slum. And I think one of my favorite statements about this was a friend of mine once, in describing Luanda, and I think he picked this up from somewhere else, I don't know the original source, made the point that it wasn't the, if you want, the slum, the Musek that invaded the city, it was the city that invaded yeah. the slum. And so if we switch our idea and say, actually, the originary point is not the ideal, it's kind of the mess, so to say, what types of urban formations or urban desires are we left with? And I think I find it very difficult, and I think most people find it really difficult to think outside that, because the whole point of state intervention mm-hmm. is to move towards this teleology of something mm-hmm. which is never idealized. I think speech and context, what type of power does it give? And I think this is where our two presentations are kind of intersecting and diverging in some senses. And you know, I think the language of the slum, when it's used sort of analytically, really does have this power to say we need to sort of wipe things out. At the same time, I don't know how we get at a concept like the racialization of urban space, dispossession, if we don't understand the kinds of connotations which slum carries. I think when the state starts, you know, so in Angola, very often they'll call areas risk areas, areas of high risk, as opposed to using the word slum. Right, and that completely effaces everything about how these areas right. came to be. I think we need to start actually, I think basically what we need to do is start interrogating the object of the city and start thinking about what the city is when the slum is the originary point mm-hmm. and taking all of that on.
A response from...
Yeah, and thank you. I mean, these are indeed huge questions. But, first of all, obviously, language is not everything. Mm-hmm. And we could imagine a world very similar to the one in which we live, where the concept and the ideology of slum isn't used, but something quite similar is. And the sort of institutional and structural powers would likely not have too much problem mobilizing these other concepts as well, but it does indeed do a lot. And I think you're right that there's a sort of theory of urbanization behind it, and the sort of idea is that there's, as you said, the normal city, and then this other, the slum, that is somehow abnormal. And even though it's a shadow that sort of runs through the history of industrial capitalist urbanization, it's still imagined as this sort of autonomous other realm that can be excised, you know, without addressing the accumulation processes that produce it, as well as other spaces. So I really do think we should look at the ways in which the frame of the slum legitimizes that and sort of draws links between different movements, different institutions, different processes. I also think we should really pay attention to the sort of specificity of the return of the slum in our present world, because I think there is this sort of global development establishment and urbanist establishment of which social science and universities are a part, as well as NGOs and the UN and so many other institutions. There's this sort of global urban development establishment, and the concept of slum circulates very freely through there, and it's one of the main sites where this idea is created and reproduced. And I think it's important to sort of look at the specificity of the concept in this world as well. I mean, just to some extent, at stake in the question of what is the reality of the slum, it's partly a sort of struggle between different branches of the sort of urbanist establishment and different branches of the growth machine. And I mean, it does sort of invite particular forms of expertise and legitimate knowledge. And you can see it sort of being used to empower some actors in this development process than others. So I mean, I think there's sort of multiple dimensions of struggle within which we can locate this term.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm just going to ask one quick question, and then we're going to open it up to the floor. I really appreciated the way that you tried to shift the discussion that sort of problematizes the binary between the city and the slum by forcing us or inviting us to think about the slum as a city. And it raises questions about whether even the idea of city is something that is universally understood. And when we talk about the city, are we talking about a very particular Western industrial concept of a city, or are we talking about cities across all times and all locations? So I think being mindful, your presentations make me want to be much more mindful about the sort of very specificity of the term city itself and its sort of sociological, historical, and cultural implications. But this is a largely selfish question, which is methodological. So if the category of slum is problematic, difficult, effacing, disempowering, as a researcher, what are the new sort of categories, or what are the methodologies, or the more sort of precise questions we should be asking in order to really sort of get to the heart of how to understand this urban phenomenon that is a city that doesn't fully have a name yet. So what are the new, what are techniques, what are methods, what are the questions we should be asking instead of, you know, circulating around the same sort of ball?
Yeah, são muitas coisas a pensar, não é? Quer dizer, uma das coisas que eu acho que nós não devemos esquecer é que, de fato, cidades como o Rio de Janeiro e favelas, né, têm um elemento de pobreza evidente, né? Então, os programas sociais, é evidente que são bem-vindos. Né?
There are many things for us to think about. And one thing that we cannot forget is that when we talk about cities like Rio de Janeiro and slums, very obvious element is poverty. Of course, there are programs to combat poverty, and those are welcome.
Através de moradia. Mas a questão não é exatamente essa. Né? O problema não é a existência ou não de pobres. Né? É de que maneira essa cidade pode ser representada com uma morfologia mista, né? Esse é o problema, né? Ou seja, a cidade não precisa ter clusters arquitetônicos modernos, ao lado de favelas e entender que uma coisa é diferente da outra.
In terms of housing, the problem is not whether there are poor people or not. The problem is how to demonstrate this in a mixed morphology. We don't need to have clusters of modern architecture next to slums to understand this.
Yes, the problem is understand the city like a mixed space. And this is the question, why we are insisted and debate about the slum like a different thing.
Right, right. No, I understand.
This is the question for
me.
This is a great question, and I think it points to the importance of urban theory and social theory and of being able to find a space to problemize terms and to try to rethink concepts. I was saying that it's valuable to think about the process, and not only the process of urbanization, which sort of avoids this question of, you know, which city are we talking about, because I think, obviously it's true that there's all these sort of different models of cities, but I think rather than sort of having stuck in our mind one sort of static model, we should sort of see the process by which all these different forms are produced. But we should think about the sort of process of dispossession was the language that I was thinking would be useful. I mean, the key is to repoliticize this idea, to capture the elements of antagonism and the relationality of it. So not to see slums as sort of self-generating spaces within the city, but how this sort of urban process in general also leads to immense concentrations of wealth. And to sort of see the connections between all of these, and not just on the urban scale, and also not just on the sort of regional or global scales, but sort of between scales and producing new scales. But it's sort of, I don't know why it's important to problematize our terms and to sort of see the connections between a concepts like slum and other assumptions that people have about sort of what the urban is and how it works. So I guess I'm saying we maybe should unbracket the urbanization question, but I don't know.
Okay, and last word, and then we open up. Yep.
Yeah, I mean, I think to build off the other two speakers, I really think the issue of relationality and really trying to locate areas that we might call slums into just the city and think about what happens to those spaces analytically when we do that. One of the things which I've tried to do a lot is sometimes just say, okay, this is the neighborhood where I do work. So what does it do when I just call it a neighborhood as opposed to a special type of neighborhood, for instance? Like what happens to my own analysis and to kind of the frame that I'm using when that happens? And I'm just going to say one more thing. While the slum, the term, does carry all these connotations, I don't think it necessarily has to be effacing. And I really do think there's important kind of, I think especially if we look at local terms that are used, I think there are sort of important historical knowledges that are caught up with them. So, yeah, so if I think of, again, sorry, the word in Angola, musek, it's apparently originally meant to have come from kind of the Kumbundu word, meaning place of sand, which juxtaposed it to the cement city of the colonial era. So it carries this history of kind of materiality, of dispossession, of all of that, but in that moment where it comes from, links it, in fact, to the city, to that process. Yeah. It helps you understand a process whereby Black Africans were forced out of the city center to the periphery. And so I actually very often will use that term because I don't think a term like peri-urban settlement helps me explain that history at all. It's much more powerful, and it's the term that people have in their head in their everyday. Right. And if we can't deal with that, we can't understand why people feel so aggrieved when the slum is pushed down, for instance. I think it can be effacing. I also think it's sometimes incredibly key to work with that term and see how people use it and how it kind of has these connotations.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry, can I just, I totally...
Quick. Yeah. This is going to continue over lunch, I can tell. We already had it. Well, there's a... Clara had a question. Clara, I think you were the first. Well, we already had lunch, didn't we?
Thank you for your presentations. And this is a question for David. I really appreciated the critical approach that you made towards the term slum, but I was frustrated by your conclusion to suggest that we should understand slums as spaces of dispossession is only half truth, and to a certain extent it even reproduces what you were criticizing, because these so-called slums are also spaces of great assets. The land is generally an asset, most particularly because of its location. The houses are often assets, but more importantly, the people with their entrepreneurial skills and will, with their levels of organization, with their sense of community and place, and in response to Matsipa's comment, this is the approach I think that we need to take to look at these places and act on them differently. The approach of mapping, understanding, and acting upon assets. And I think the approach of not reading these slums from the outside, but reading them from within, reading them with the people, have the people read them for us as an organic or organic intellectuals, as Gramsci would put it.
Okay. Do you want?
Yeah, no, thank you. That's an excellent point, and I completely agree with you. I sort of settled on this frame of dispossession partly to link the production of these spaces to the concept of accumulation by dispossession, but largely just to capture the antagonistic and relational sort of dimensions of them. So I think you're right that there's a risk of sort of seeing, I don't know, reproducing the purely sort of negative frame here. But yeah, I was just trying to sort of highlight the element of struggle that you sort of see in these spaces and between these spaces and elsewhere in the city.
We're quickly running out of time, so we're going to take two questions in succession and then leave it for our panel to do the closing remarks. So, Mike? Has Gavin repossessed the mic?
It's there.
We have a question here and a question
over there. It's the two questions here, sorry.
So we're going to take two questions in a row first.
Get away from the over-intellectualization of slums and concentrate on the development of a methodology for, you know, creating some policies to eliminate it. For the first, what I'm doing is I'm looking at urban history. You know, when slums were created, you know, from industrial capitalism in the 18th century. And you know how in the West, you know, we've sort of eliminated them, you know, by, you know, development of infrastructure and different things like this. And if there's anything from that we can, that, you know, can be applied for policy in, say, in Africa, you know, where the slums are. And that's sort of what I'm working on now. And I mean, I just wanted to throw that out. Thank you.
Thank you all for your papers. This is a question specifically to Claudia, though, which is I really liked your work, and I like this idea very much of the kind of aesthetic imaginary of the ideal city as it's instantiated in the slums. I was wondering, though, like with this, the contrast between the images you showed of like the first image of the poster of the developed real estate development, the second with this this plan of the for the slum, whether this was, how much you see this as a kind of aesthetic imaginary, or and how much you see this as a kind of pragmatic strategies which really speak to current trends of financialization of the slums. Because it seems like, you know, just what you focused in on the wall and the grid, these are exactly the instruments, official instruments of, you know, privatizing land and converting, you know, usufruct lands into like microcredit collateral and things like this. So it's almost like dispensing away with the whole problem of that has faced the slums of their financialization, you know, in the eyes of NGOs, UN Habitat, and financial institutions, by having there be no possible kind of land dispute questions when you have the wall and the grid. So that's all. Sorry, that was a little long.
Okay. So I will start with Ginger's question. So I don't think we need to separate the aesthetic imaginary from a pragmatic strategy. I think the aesthetic strategy, the aesthetics becomes a pragmatic strategy here to try and hold on to your asset. And in fact, the people who are building those houses know precisely that they're massive financial assets. That's why they're, one of the things I was always so surprised by, and I shouldn't have been surprised, working with people who'd been dispossessed of their homes, was there was kind of a very standard talk of always kind of the process of trauma of losing the house, but immediately afterwards it was about the financial loss. Because basically people are not using banks, their house is their bank, right?
No, I just wanted to say quickly, because it's very well formulated what you just said, that if you ask what we're looking at here, you're looking at capital. I mean, we're looking at, and in some level, that's how to name this this situation. So you just, I'm just reinforcing.
Yeah, so I think, I think we need to, I'm not saying you're doing this, but I think there's a tendency sometimes to think that people who live in slum areas don't recognize the financial worth of what they're sitting on. And they very much do, and I think that's actually a big part of the struggle over housing at the moment. If someone comes and knocks down your house, you've lost thousands and thousands of dollars in investment, and it's almost impossible to recover from that in any fast way. So I think the aesthetic becomes the pragmatic strategy precisely to holding on to that. I think the poor, as with the rich, have been totally caught up in kind of the capital, the financialization of land markets.
Yeah. Oh. I just got the sign from the side. I'm very sorry that we have to cut the conversation short. But hopefully we can continue this over lunch or over dinner. So I'm going to hand over to, first of all, thank you to the panel. Thank you very much, Marielis, Claudia, David, and also Reinhold for fascinating conversation. I have learned a lot from your various perspectives, and I hope to engage you further on it. But I'd also like to welcome Professor Hilary Sample from Columbia University, Nora Akawi from Studio X Amman, and Rajiv Thacker from Studio X Mumbai to present the next panel.
Thank you. Thanks.
microphone.
Okay, hello, welcome. My name is Rajiv Thacker. I'm a curator for Studio X Mumbai, and I'm here to, along with Nora Cowie, director of Studio X Amman, introduce the next panel for today's talk and discussion. Once again, I'd like to thank GSAPP, Amal, Columbia Global Centers, along with all the speakers that have made it out here today on this to discuss this important issue of housing the majority, slums, informality, and a bunch of other ideas that we're discussing today. Our next panel takes on questions of representation. And I think through the diversity of speakers we've assembled for this to represent, in a way, a multiplicitous and varied set of perspectives on interpreting what representation, when related to issues of slums, informality, and the concept of housing itself. Through a cross-disciplinary approach, we hope to address the cultural, social, visual, political, spatial perspectives on how representation of informal conditions and their constituents affect political voice and agency, and possibly addressing issues of visibility, creating opportunities for political change within the system. In this, and I hope through the speakers and the presentations, that we could also delve a little bit on the idea and suggest that we develop a kind of more conceptual framework of ideals or effects and words which carry more substantial meaning and could give us a better ability to then translate our ideas into multiple representations, currently accepted, supported, criticized, and contested in the different spaces globally around the world where we're discussing this issue. Our speakers for today are not only architects, they are filmmakers, they are geographers, and they are professors of comparative literature, so we hope to have a very diverse and interesting conversation. Our first speaker today is Alfredo Brienborg from Urban Think Tank and also chair of architecture and urban design at ETH Zurich. Alfredo received his bachelor's of art in architecture in 1984 and his master of science in architectural design in 1986 from Columbia University. He also has a second architecture degree from the Central University of Venezuela in 1992, when him and Hubert Klumpner founded Urban Think Tank in Caracas, Venezuela. Starting in 2007, Brienborg has been a guest professor at the Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation, Columbia University, where he co-founded the Sustainable Living Urban Model Laboratory, or Slum Lab. And since 2010, Brienborg and Klumpner hold the chair of architecture and urban design at the ETH in Zurich. Switzerland, please welcome Alfredo Brienborg.
Thank you very much, Rajiv. Thank you, Amal. So these are two latest magazines of Slum Lab as Columbia's collaborators, so I'll give them to the dean so she doesn't forget. Yes, and we will begin the conference. So here we have urban village, open building. Yeah, I prefer now to use the term of these urban villages. So what we were calling slum, actually slum lab, was a play on the word itself to unpack the lexicon of the term slum. That's what we call the sustainable living urban lab. So, but now we're using more the term urban villages, and you know that these urban villages exist all over, from Shenzhen to Caracas, right? A lot of interesting things were said in the beginning. How do I get this going here? Okay. So the important thing now is to
understand that housing is man-made, and it is, and the scarcity of housing is also made and produced as part of the economic realities of cities. But today, let's say, our work is about the practice of architecture and building a kind of critical idea of the practice, because you can't be an architect without a concept. So our concept was right in our faces, because I come from Caracas, Venezuela. If you don't know, it's been 18 years now in a revolution, and it's all been all about the politics of the city. In fact, that revolution is playing itself out in the city streets. So Hubert and I, when we started the urban think tank, we did it quite intentionally against what our practices, our normal daily practices that we had had up to 1996, when we decided to change and focus on a very visible problem, which was this informal housing, which our first book in 2003 coined informal city, right? But what we wanted to do is to create what Edward Said has said is kind of a median state. Not the status quo of government, not the individual affiliations, my personal ones, my biographies, but actually a kind of third condition, independent, in between, that Said is called median state, like the middle, right? And so we need to find new ways of representation of this space, as we heard in the first panel, as Lefebvre tried to coin in the 60s the triad. Maybe some of you will know the perceived space, the conceived space, and the lived space. So we went on, because this panel is about representation, Hubert and I went on to study the building stock of housing in Caracas. 60% of the population in Caracas lives in the informal housing. So why? Because as Le Corbusier's book, maybe you guys don't know, this is Vers une architecture, this is the first cover of that book, where Architecture Revolution, he was coming back from Moscow, he knew very well that either we made architecture, and this was the time of industrialization, or we would get revolution, which we did in Caracas, because they didn't build enough social housing. So the real problem is, do we want a weak state, or do we want a strong state? Do we want a state a lot of people, in the book Slum Planet has argued for that the state should be involved in a strong policy on social housing, or do we want a weaker state and actually let social housing just happen? People moving to the city, building their own city, right? So what you have here is a real pixelated GIS map that shows you the growth of informality or slums in the world population from now to 2030. It was done together with Christian Vertman at Harvard. So how do you see it? Are we in a good position or in a bad position? That's the point. What we need to redefine our understanding of urbanization, as we heard today, the terms are very bad. So we need to understand why. We need who we're going to interpret or what we're going to interpret, act where, identify with whom we're going to act. Because this is the reality of Caracas. If you don't fly over this in a helicopter, you won't know it. In fact, most of the residents, let's say the 5% of rich Caraqueños, have never been into these areas, and neither had we. But it was so in our face with the revolution, with the politics, that we couldn't but address it in our work. So we started to map it. These are the first maps ever came out of real digital GIS of where the informal settlements were in Caracas. Of course, there was a previous book that started to map it, but it was changing so rapidly that we had finally produced in 2005 the most accurate map. Then here you have Rio de Janeiro, and what you see, Rio has smaller favelas, but many more. Of course, they're kind of embedded. So we started to unpack, and our book talks about it, how people plug into infrastructures, how these settlements, these urbanities plug into infrastructure, or on the periphery, or they plug into workforces, etc. And then here you see Bogota, and you see Bogota's right on the periphery of the growth. Or here you see Buenos Aires, also kind of embedded in. So these were or Tijuana border. We did this along with Teddy Cruz. So it started to represent. How do we represent these realities? Or Mexico City, where you see the informality right dead in the middle, right? And so this is Lefebvre's quote. But maybe some of you remember Giancarlo Di Carlo, who said, in reality, architecture has become too important to be left to architects, he declared. And the real metamorphosis that we need is to develop new characteristics in the practice of architecture and housing. What we need is new behavior patterns. Therefore, to break down the barriers between builders and users. Exactly. The same, because they are essentially the same planning process. The intrinsic aggressiveness of social housing and the forced passivity of the user must dissolve into a condition of creative and decisional equivalence. So what we have now is people have built up their cities, but obviously in the worst areas and the worst topographies of the city. So it is the architect and architectural education, regardless of what school or who conceives it, like today, GSAPP, for instance, that has the responsibility to find ways in which to debunk the myths. So not all the slums or the informality is not the problem, it's a solution. Everyone has a right to come to the city, right? You can't gate the city, and so on and so forth. Debunking, I won't go through everything. You guys can read some of our books. So architecture spatializes and materializes uneven development. That's key. So we, as architects, have been complicit in the process. That's the whole point. And we have, the question is not whether these buildings and sustainable buildings are what we should be teaching here. The question is it sustainable to have 33% of the world population living in poverty? It's not, obviously. So we created the Slum Lab here at Columbia University with great collaborators. And we started to understand that to tackle this problem, we had to go multidisciplinary, right? So we started to imagine what these hills, the magic mountain, we say, with cable cars and housings and all of that. We came up with some books that tried to diagnose topography, visualize social factors, diagnose morphology, reverse engineer the aggregation, capture resource, add infrastructure. And then, of course, some of you know the cable car project. And here it is, that it was the first time a cable car was built in a loop 2.4 kilometers and plugged into the subway. And it's not just like a ring of pearls, but actually it had infrastructures like gymnasiums, libraries, all attached to it. So people is infrastructure. So we forgot that the users are at the core of our profession. We've somehow been talking to architects, or we've been just talking to the client. The client has been, we've been addressing our work to the client. But no, it's the people. And so we started as an NGO, understanding of trying to figure out how to enter into my own hometown, Caracas. So we began with these people, some of the nannies that took care of the family kids and stuff, their children, their daughters, their cousins, and we went into Petare, which is that hill, massive hill, one of the largest slums in the world, right? And but this, what you're seeing, this division by the highway, formal and informal, is actually frozen politics. So it was mentioned very good that that preceded me, politics at the core, because this is an expropriation process and has a whole history of an old farm that was here and giving some benefits to one owner and none to the other settlers. But we became much more interested in process. We became interested in photographing the same building over time, a little bit Camilo Vergara. So you see the top of that balcony being finished, and we came to the conclusion that people don't want mortgages. They don't want to pay for a little box in a social housing block, you know, Pruitt-Igoe was mentioned, and then pay for it over 30 years. What people want is to build their own house with zero mortgage over time. So we want to build one room at a time, one kitchen at a time. So how, we call this the growing house. And how did we kind of get into that? This is Oscar Genaro. He was 89 at the moment. He was one of the first residents of Petare. The social, he had a great archive of him and his brother, actually a pirate urbanist, if you want, making sublotting, banking the hill for cousins, for uncles, etc. And then over time, that hill became urbanized. And actually, curiously enough, with no regulations, it's very homogeneous. The spans, the houses, the boxes, it would be the ideal of a Swiss village, right? Or as Ken has said, kind of an Italian hill town in quotation marks. But that led us to what's more interesting to me, is how we go from theory to practice, how we go from social work into practice, representation, how we create discourse on it. So we began to think, can we make these open buildings that are kind of urban villages and vertical? And we thought, well, let's try it out. We got the Anglican Church to give us a little try. So over the parish house, it was a time of a flood, 99. The Anglican Church let us make a little structure that is floating over the white building, the parish house. And then people were building apartments, and we made a flexible steel structure span between the concrete so that people could build stairs and make their own apartments in whatever way. There you see a more finished version of that house. But the idea was the building could grow, so we made foundations for it to grow. Then later, under the Metro Company, we were given this standard apartment, 75 square meters, and they said, can you do some housing at the bottom of the cable car project? So this is Avenida Lecuna, so we start to look at police stations, old people's homes, housing. And we said, oh, that's not very good. We started to say, can we make a housing prototype that has an internal street, the street in the air, the Smithsons, of course. We're harking back to some of the work of Team 10, collaborative work. And then because Caracas has an undulating topography, and we don't build one unique piece of architecture, but we make prototypes that can be recreated, reproduced, open source, we can connect to any other building or connect to a hill. So you can enter and go four floors down, four floors up without an elevator. That's interesting. So that was the idea, and to make these clusters that are kind of little villages. And those clusters would have, in the street, you'd have all kinds of programs. So we started to dream about building that with the Metro Company, and we got hit with kind of some nasty politics at a certain moment. And but then we came across the Torre David. Torre David, the tallest squat in the world. You guys know it. It's an office building, 45 floors in the air, an open structure, a product of a banking crisis. It is a beautiful metaphor for the story of Caracas because it's the boom and the bust. And that's what's so interesting about the story here. Again, Giancarlo De Carlo, who talks about how the architects in the 1970s had kind of neglected the problems, these very imminent problems of the city and slums, etc. So some people would say, but this is like a slum. I was criticized by my colleagues in Caracas. They wanted to throw me out of the School of Architecture, all these things, because I presented this at the Venice Biennale. And they said, this is not a true representation of architecture, but it's a little bit like the urinal when Duchamp put it in the museum. He questioned what is art. When we put this into the Venice Biennale, we question what is architecture. So I think it's architecture, and it's certainly not a slum because it's hard infrastructure, it's plugged into the metro, everyone that lives there worked in a 1 mile radius, etc., etc., and it's relatively safe. Right, it looks like one. So we created polemics, we put newspaper articles, everything that was happening at the moment around the building, we put it in that Biennale, and we made, and all kinds of articles came out in Latin America, all over, where people just couldn't understand that we were decontextualizing misery. But actually, we had been living 1 year inside the building with the inhabitants. So the book will reflect that, any of you who have read it. And in that book, we tell the story how the inhabitants themselves were one wanted us to put this in the museum and put this in the Arsenale because they needed to raise polemics, so they were given housing. Either the building was to be fixed up, which was an illusion, after all, that it's such an expensive vertical building in the heart of the city, owned by the government, would be given over for an experiment. But in the end, we did a whole photographic series with Ivan Ban. The residents loved it, looking at themselves. And the building was kind of the hardware, and the software was how people adapted to it, right? It's quite interesting, every apartment. And you would think that it's a slum, but actually not. So the building's in red, and we showed where people worked in the one radius around the city. In red, but it's not very clear in this diagram, we showed where people were living, the circulation diagram, the sun diagrams, then slowly, progressively, how people built their homes inside. In an office building, they were given allotments, right? And this is Gladys with her two daughters. And she just dreams of a condition of a middle-class home just like you and I. And shops in the building and basketball courts in the lobby, which played other neighborhood basketball games. And slowly, people upgraded over 17 years into fantastically interesting apartments. So what the government was unable to do, the residents did themselves with their own microfinancing system. And then, of course, we thought about dreaming with them of making water tanks, microelectrical systems, elevator towers that might stand outside as a public infrastructure, windmills on the top, etc. We tried to get public funding for that, and it became a whole polemic. And now, the aftermath is about half the residents have been taken out at gunpoint, but been given houses 65 kilometers on the outskirts of the city. I'm sure Tatiana Bilbao will talk more about these developments on the outskirts of cities by Infonavit in Mexico, which have created ghettos in and of themselves. But the people will not reject taking that house, because then they'll sell it and come right back into the city. So the story's not over, and the politics in Venezuela is not over. So I just want to take you in to our next project, which I think is very illustrative of a process of an architect working in these areas and how it's multidisciplinary. This is, maybe some of you know, La Casa Muraudin by Le Corbusier. Very interesting. It was under the Vichy government. Corbu tried to create a kind of vernacular that could be self-built with wood and wall and strong walls, right? And he had these wonderful drawings of how people could implement it. Well, we went into that. Of course, you know that the primitive hut, Semper, Semper was the founder of ETH, and so we liked the whole idea of going back into the housing, simple housing prototype. So we went to Cape Town and started to think about how we can reflect and maybe come up some propositions on Kailisha, one of the largest slums or settlements in Cape Town. You have 7.5 million missing housing units in 2,700 informal settlements in South Africa, right? So Kailisha is right here, and we, working with an NGO called Ikailami, found a small community that was just a tip of an RDP settlement, and the government actually looked favorably for us to think about doing an experiment of how we would not formalize the housing, but work with the residents in some kind of process. Oh, okay, sorry. Go very quickly. So our big discovery was on site when we saw a guy doing a double-story unit. And what we imagined was people building vertically, but of course it's on sand. They didn't have the technologies. So we took that back to ETH. We brought some of the community leaders, Pumezo, there. We worked out some prototypes, how they could build. And Pumezo volunteered to be the first person, one of the community leaders, to get his new house. It's a little burned out here, and it was very simple, and it's a $3,000 unit. Of course, you might know some of the other projects around the world. They do low-cost housing, but no one at $3,000. So we take the urbanization, and we work with the community to kind of refit them or re-block them, and I'll just finish very quickly, in a process that's a game, that's a community-driven, who wants a double story, who wants a triple story, and over time, with courtyards, using the courtyards as the element, and working with every one of the residents, we've come up with a prototype, and we will begin to build. And this is how people will move from one shack to another, to clusters that where they will be grouped. And these are the firewalls for the double shacks, because we create a double shack, one that pays for the subsidy of the one that's the resident that's there. So we duplicate the density, and that's how we subsidize the experiment. But we see it all being done as a kit of parts and being built by the residents themselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alfredo. Our next speaker is Ramin Birani. He's from the Columbia University School of the Arts. Ramin is a writer-director. His five feature films have all premiered at the Venice and Cannes film festivals and also screened at the Sundance, Berlin, and Toronto film festivals as well. Ramin has won numerous awards, including the Critics' Prize for Best Film in Venice, Goodbye Solo in 2009, and a Guggenheim Fellowship amongst many others. In 2010, legendary film critic Roger Ebert proclaimed Ramin Birani as the director of the decade. His latest film, 99 Homes, stars Andrew Garfield, Michael Shannon, and Laura Dern, and premiered at the Venice, Telluride, Toronto, and Sundance Film Festivals, and will be released later this year. Ramin?
Hello. I'm sorry, I have a bit of a cold, so you'll forgive me. I feel like I'm an intruder here because it's not my specialty, but my co-writer on four of my films comes from architecture background. Her whole family, they're all architects. And I want to mention her bookstore in Paris, Le Cabanon, named after Corbusier's studio, which is a great architecture and design bookstore in Paris. So maybe somehow through her I have some interest in architecture, and she wagged her finger at me that I have to do this event. I make fiction films. I like to do a lot of research for my films. I like to spend time with people and their environments. And I think for me the easiest way to talk about things is to show some of the work. So I want to start with my first film, Man Push Cart, which was made in 2004 and was released in 2005. This was a film about push cart vendors in New York. For me, it was important, almost in all the films, to try to get to things that I felt were not being shown in cinema, things that I had not seen. New York's a city that's been filmed endlessly, and I wanted to try to show something that was new, different. And I had never seen a film about pushcart vendors. It was very much inspired by Albert Camus' Myth of Sisyphus, his essay about the absurdity of life. And so I spent a lot of time with pushcart vendors. Most of them were South Asian. The gentleman I focused on, these are all not non-professional actors. He had been a pushcart vendor. He was Pakistani. I spent a lot of time in his neighborhood in Midwood, Brooklyn, which in 2002-03, when I was researching the film, had been pretty hard hit by kind of activities after 9/11. A lot of people had just vanished. And there's some of that in the film. It's kind of hard to pick clips. But why don't we show one clip, and we'll touch on it real quickly, and then move to the next one. So this will be Man Push Cart. So the idea here, and in almost in all the clips, is going to be, again, people that are not visible, not just the representation in cinema. Specifically in this film, there was a lot of on its own. I'm not pushing it. That's okay. No problem. I'm not pushing it, but there's an undercurrent in that film a lot about what was happening after 9/11 in terms of the representation of Middle Eastern, South Asians, Muslims in the United States and elsewhere. and just what are other ways you can see these people? I'm taking real people in all these situations, at least in this and in Chomp Shop and in Goodbye Solo, which we're not going to look at, but and taking non-professional actors, taking real stories and then fictionalizing them, changing them, and trying to bring them to, hopefully, to an audience that would then see things a little bit differently. So you end up getting reactions from people at screenings or emails through a website of, I now look at this differently, which was something that was important to me in terms of humanizing some of the discussions that we've been having here today. Chop Shop is a location that, if you're in New York, you probably know about it. It's Willits Point, Queens. This was a film made in 2006 and came out in 2007. So this is a massive junkyard of factories and auto body shops right across the street from, at that time, Willits Point, from at that time, the baseball stadium, Shea Stadium, which is now, I think, called City Field, and the U.S. Open, and it's in the flight path of LaGuardia. So it's right there where people go to see baseball games, go to the U.S. Open, they fly over it, but no one has any idea that it's there. I think technically it has one resident, a guy named Joe, who I think does vote. And in The Great Gatsby, Fitzgerald called it the Valley of the Ashes. When I saw it as a location, I knew it was something that I had to film. At that time, there was a billboard at the stadium that said, "Make dreams happen, Banco Popular." I did not want a bank to dream for me and or anyone else. And so I started to wonder about the people there and what kind of lives they had. And I, again, spent a lot of time there, almost 1 year there, as my colleague was spending time with the people to understand what is their story. Again, I have a luxury of fictionalizing things, which I enjoy, but this is about children, about a brother and a sister who live and work in this auto body shop. So let's take a look at the first clip, which is actually, I think, the first part of the film. And this is, we'll see that. Because you'll get a sense of this, of Manhattan that we will never see in the film again. I think that clip continues. Can you, if you continue it, I think it will. The Chop Shop one, yeah. Then go right into the second one, I think. Yeah, good, good. Thank you. Thank you.
one.
Yes. Okay. So, as my colleague said, it's a pretty blown out image. Okay. So in the first clip, that was the beginning of the film, and it's the only time you will see Manhattan. It's the only time you'll see the skyscrapers and all the things that every movie and television show tells us is New York. Things like Friends, which I don't think relates to my existence in New York. I don't know anyone who has an apartment like that unless they're rich. And all my friends aren't white. So this was the only time you're going to see that in the film, and then you're going to go into this other world, which is what you see in the next clip. The Alejandro actually worked in that location for almost 6 months. He trained under Rob, who's the gentleman you see there. Rob actually owns that garage, and he's playing himself in the film. What was very interesting in terms of documentary and fiction, which I always think is a very fine and blurry line, I think it's just good story, is that despite that we were doing take after take with a crew of filmmakers and a team, the people in that location insisted we were making a documentary about Alejandro, who had been working for Rob for 6 months. And they saw no difference between the two. Also, some of the scenes, like the one you saw and others in the film, Alejandro's actually, you know, dealing with real customers, with the real cars that are coming to look for work. In one of the other scenes, he pushes off somebody else and gets a car in for Rob. And Rob was actually also paying him for this. He would get money for every car he would bring in. Of course, we were paying him a salary as well for acting in the film, but Alejandro was a pretty good hustler and was making some extra money on the side. So there's a mix of the two in the film. Let's see another clip. So you can see the stadium in the background, the train. Again, this it's so close to what people know, but no one knows it's there. This is where him and his sister live. They live in a little office suite up here. It was like a treehouse. I always thought it was strange that he could look out a window into another interior space. We enjoyed that. And some of the previous scene was just to get at that away from miserableism, away from just because they live in this environment, they cannot also enjoy themselves, which there was a constant mix in that location of having fun and of, you know, really hard issues they were dealing with economically, sanitation, etc. But also they would have a cookout. They would cheat one another and they would have beers together. And this was constantly happening, and we tried to have that in the film, this mix between the resilience that they had and the hardships they had, and not to portray it as just one way. Okay, so as the clock is ticking at me, the last clip I want to show is from my latest film, 99 Homes, that will come out on September 25th. This is a film that I was very interested in, the housing crisis and the economic crisis that impacted the entire world. That I picked Florida as a location. There were four states that were very hard hit by the housing crisis. One of them was Florida, so I spent, again, a lot of time researching the film. I was in foreclosure courts a lot. They're known as the rocket dockets, where they decide your fate in 60 seconds flat. I was with real estate brokers. I've been on evictions, many of them. I was with families, very normal, average, middle-class families with jobs and kids living in motels next to gangbangers and prostitutes and drug abusers. And a bus actually will pick your kids up and take them from a hotel on Highway 142 that leads to Disney World, will take them to school. This is actually happening even now today. And again, people don't expect that from America and don't think that's happening, but it is. In this film, it's Andrew Garfield's character is an out-of-work construction guy in Florida in 2010. He lives with his mom, Laura Dern, and his son, and they get evicted from their home by a real estate broker who's played by Michael Shannon. They move into one of these motels, and then in order to survive and get his home back, Andrew has to then begin working for the very man who evicted him, Michael's character, a kind of deal with the devil to get his home back. And that leads into a lot of corruption in the housing industry, scams that Michael starts to teach Andrew's character. one of the things that he ultimately has to do is he has to start evicting people just as he was evicted. And this sequence is, he's already done his first one, which was kind of very painful for him. Now he's getting deeper into it. He's making money, and now he has a lot of people in a row that he's going to have to evict, and this is the last clip we'll see. Because the film will have a wider release and it's got movie stars, so I can sneak my bomb under the table and surprise people with something other than an X-Men film. Thank you.
Thank you, Raman. Our next speaker is Gelson de Souza e Silva. He's a geographer and associate professor at the Fluminense Federal University, and he's the founder and director of the Favelas Observatory, an NGO that's located at Favela da Mari, the largest slum in Rio de Janeiro. He's former Secretary of Education from the municipality of Nova Iguaçu in the state of Rio de Janeiro, former Subsecretary of the State Cabinet on Human Rights and Social Assistance, and he's member of the Council of the City and of the City Information Council at Pereira Passos Institute. He's author of numerous books, including Why Some But Not Others and Favela, Pain and Happiness in the City. He holds a master's on, and doctoral degree in sociology of education from PUC in Rio de Janeiro. Thank you.
Boa tarde. A gente vai ter tradução simultânea, ou como é que vai ser? Até o quê?
Good afternoon.
Boa tarde a todos e a todas. My English is very poor, então, I so prefer speaking in Portuguese. Eu vim de longe para estar aqui com vocês hoje.
I came a long way to be here with you today.
E para a gente estar junto aqui tem que ter algum sentido. Para ter uma viagem tão longa, para falar com vocês 10 minutos, eu quero falar exatamente o que vai dentro de mim.
So, there has to be some meaning for me to come such a long way to speak for 10 minutes here.
Eu sou intelectual, como meus dados, meu currículo apresenta. Eu sou professor da universidade.
I am an intellectual, as my CV shows. I'm a university professor.
Sou um doutor.
I am a PhD.
Mas sou, antes de tudo, um favelado.
But above all, I'm a slum resident.
Eu nasci e cresci em favelas do Rio de Janeiro.
I was born in and I grew up in a slum in Rio de Janeiro.
Eu me tornei o que eu sou, aprendi o que eu sou vivendo nas favelas do Rio de Janeiro.
I became what I am and I learned what I am by living in a slum in Rio.
Conheci minha mulher, que eu amo muito, está aqui comigo, também na favela do Rio de Janeiro e também é uma doutora.
I met my wife in a favela in Rio de Janeiro. She's also a PhD.
E tudo isso para falar que o que a gente está tratando aqui é da complexidade da experiência humana, a experiência da complexidade da cidade. A cidade é complexa, a favela é complexa, as pessoas são complexas.
I'm here to talk all of this to tell you about the complexity of the human existence. Cities are complex, favelas are complex.
E tradicionalmente, as pessoas tentam tratar uma questão complexa de uma forma muito simples.
Traditionally, people want to deal with a complex issue in a very simple manner.
Essas fotos mostram favelas do Rio de Janeiro.
These pictures show favelas in Rio.
E outros espaços da cidade do Rio de Janeiro.
As well as other spaces in the city of Rio de Janeiro.
Elas mostram inventividade, criação,
they show inventiveness, creativity,
alegria,
happiness,
tristeza,
sadness,
dor, mostram vidas humanas complexas.
These are complex human lives.
E tradicionalmente a favela continua ainda sendo definida, como David Hammond trouxe aqui, a partir do que eu chamo de paradigma da carência.
And traditionally, favelas are treated as defined as David Madden said, as paradigmas de
da carência, da ausência.
Of need, of absence.
Através de uma visão dos setores normalmente que eu chamo de sociocêntrica, uma visão sociocentrada, principalmente das classes dominantes, se define a favela pelo que ela não teria, pelo que ela não seria.
From a social-centric viewpoint, which is defined by the dominant class, the favela is defined by what it does not have, by what it is not.
A favela, então, seria aquele lugar que não tem equipamentos.
So favelas would be the places where there is no equipment.
Não tem serviços.
There are no services.
Não tem regras.
No rules.
No moral. Não tem lei.
No morals and no laws.
É a não cidade. É a não cidade.
It is the non-city.
É a negação da cidade.
It is the negation of a city.
E que eu e minha organização, eu sou um ativista social.
I am a social activist and my organization and I.
Minha organização chama-se Observatório de Favelas.
My organization is called Favelas Observatory.
Propomos olhar a favela e para a cidade a partir de outro paradigma.
Our proposal is to look at favelas and the city through another paradigm.
A partir do paradigma da potência.
Through the paradigm of power.
É óbvio que a favela tem carências e demandas.
Of course there are needs and demands in the favelas.
E a favela tem necessidades de regulação.
And favelas need have regulation needs.
Mas a favela é principalmente o desafio de um conjunto de pessoas que clamam pelo direito à cidade e garantem, sem o apoio do Estado e do mercado, muitas vezes, esse direito à cidade.
But favelas are furthermore the claim to the right to the city.
Então nosso desafio fundamental é reconhecer a favela a partir desse lugar de potência e de complexidade dos seus moradores.
So our challenge is to look at favelas through the viewpoint of power and complexity.
Muitos de vocês são arquitetos, são urbanistas, produzem ações, equipamentos e serviços para os pobres e para as favelas.
Many of you are architects and you produce equipment and services for the poor, for the favelas.
Você tem que escolher como é que vocês vão pensar a favela.
You have to choose, you have to decide how you're going to think about favelas.
Se vão vê-las como um lugar da carência e da precariedade, onde podem fazer o que quiserem.
If you will think of favelas as a needy place or as a precarious place where you can do as you wish.
Ou como lugar da invenção, da criatividade, das possibilidades, e vão aceitar construir as obras de vocês, os serviços de vocês, em parceria, em proximidade com seus moradores.
Or you will choose to look at it as a place of invention and build your services and your projects in partnership with the residents.
Isso não é uma escolha trivial?
That's not a trivial choice.
Quando nós esse projeto que vocês essas fotos são de um projeto nosso de fotografia.
These photos are from a photography project that we conducted.
Nós já formamos centenas de fotógrafos.
We have graduated hundreds of photographers.
Favelados e não favelados.
Both residents and non-residents of favelas.
E o que a gente mais buscou ensinar a eles foi olhar a favela a partir da sua realidade.
And the most pleasurable part of the project was to teach them how to see the favela through the reality of the favela.
E não a partir simplesmente da representação tradicional.
And not based on the traditional representation.
Mas quando nós fomos apresentar a uma empresa para financiar esse projeto, fomos pedir financiamento.
When we presented the project to a company, to a corporation to request funding.
Teve um diretor da empresa que virou para a gente a primeiro momento e falou: eu nunca apoiarei um projeto como esse.
And a director turned to us and said point blank that he would never support a project like this.
Vocês são os enganadores, manipuladores.
They said that we are cheaters, that we are manipulators.
O que os jovens da favela precisam é de oficinas de cabeleireiro, barbeiro, marceneiro, pedreiro.
What the youth in the favela need are workshops on cutting hair and working with wood and other.
Precisam de coisas úteis, produtivas.
They need useful, productive things.
É uma ilusão querer formar garotos da favelas como fotógrafos, cineastas, jornalistas, publicitários.
He said it is an illusion to want to teach photography or cinema or advertising to favela youth.
Felizmente, ele foi demitido e a gente conseguiu construir o projeto depois.
Fortunately, he was fired and we were able to fund the project.
O desafio de vocês também é igual de um arquiteto que tivemos lá na favela da Maré, a maior do Rio de Janeiro.
Your challenge is the same challenge as an architect that came to the Maré favela in Rio.
Ele construiu um lindíssimo projeto que ganhou um prêmio internacional.
He built a beautiful project and won an international prize.
Só que esse projeto, as casas não podiam ser expandidas. Ele construiu a casa para que elas ficassem exatamente do jeito que era.
But according to his project, to his design, the houses could not be expanded. They were designed to be the same, to be unaltered.
Não sei como falar em inglês, mas as casas não tinham laje.
I don't know how to say it in English, but the houses did not have a ceiling that could be built upon.
E laje é fundamental na favela.
That structure on the ceiling is fundamental in the favela.
Porque você pode deixar laje como herança para seus filhos.
Because you can leave that as an inheritance for your children.
Você pode vender a laje e conseguir uma reserva econômica.
You can use that, you can sell it and use it as a economic reserve.
E a laje é uma fantástica área de lazer.
And this area on top of your house is a fantastic place for leisure.
E eu penso que as pessoas que premiaram esse arquiteto jamais viveram numa favela ou prestaram atenção nos seus moradores.
I think that those people who gave a prize to this architect never lived in a favela or never thought about the needs of their residents.
Então, o que nós estamos falando é a construção do que nós queremos não é simplesmente de moradia para as pessoas nas favelas. Nós estamos falando, desculpe.
So what I'm saying is that we don't need just to build houses, housing for the residents.
Eu estou discutindo com vocês um conceito de cidade.
What I'm talking about is a concept of a city.
Então, a primeira coisa que nós temos que perceber, favela é cidade.
So the first thing we need to realize is that favelas are a city.
O que caracteriza mais a beleza da cidade é o encontro das diferenças.
And it is beautiful, and it represents the meaning of the differences.
Querer acabar com as favelas e transformá-las num bairro qualquer é negar essa pluralidade.
To want to end favelas and transform it into a city is to negate this plurality.
O desafio então é garantir que a favela tenha todos os equipamentos e serviços dignos e de excelência.
So the challenge is to provide dignified equipment and services for the favela.
Mas que ela mantenha a sua riqueza e as suas características.
And at the same time that the favela may keep its richness and its characteristics.
São três princípios fundamentais para uma boa vida na cidade.
There are three fundamental principles for a good life in the city.
Primeiro, o direito da gente viver a nossa autenticidade, como dizia Rousseau. A nossa singularidade.
The first is the right to live our singularity.
De eu ter direito de ser a pessoa que eu queira ser.
To have the right to be the person that I want to be.
O segundo direito fundamental é da igualdade e da dignidade humana. Que eu seja tratado com dignidade e tenha um patamar básico de dignidade para todos.
The second basic right is the right to human dignity, to be treated with human dignity, in the same level.
O governo no Brasil gastou R$1 bilhão, quase 400 milhões de dólares, numa favela de 100 mil moradores, o Morro do Alemão.
The government spent almost $400 million in a favela in the area of Alemão.
E escolheu construir um teleférico, como foi apresentado no vídeo anterior.
And it chose to build a tram.
Isso faz apenas 30% dos moradores dessa favela têm saneamento básico.
But only 30% of the residents of the favela have basic sanitation.
E os moradores não foram perguntados se preferiam o teleférico ou o saneamento básico.
Nobody asked the residents whether they prefer the tram or basic sanitation.
Isso é respeitar a dignidade do morador.
That's to disrespect the dignity of the residents.
E o terceiro ponto central para a vida na cidade ou na vida na polis é o direito à convivência.
The third right is the right to live with other people.
Isso significa o terceiro princípio da tríade da Revolução Francesa, é o direito à fraternidade.
That's the third principle of the French Revolution, the right to fraternity.
Talvez a gente nunca saiba o que aqueles revolucionários queriam dizer com o direito à fraternidade.
Maybe we will never know what those revolutionaries meant by the right to fraternity.
Eu traduzo como direito a conviver com o diferente de forma fraterna.
I translate it as to mean the right to live with different people in a fraternal relationship.
E a respeito disso, a favela tem muito a ensinar ao conjunto da cidade.
And in that regard, favelas have much to teach to the cities.
o idoso, o deficiente físico, a criança e um conjunto de outras minorias têm o direito a conviver com muito mais liberdade e respeito na favela do que em muitos bairros ricos?
The elderly, the physically challenged and children and other minorities have the right to live with liberty with other people.
O papel dos arquitetos e urbanistas é tornar a cidade mais humana, permitir que a gente conviva melhor nele, nas nossas diferenças, nos nossos encontros. A questão que você tem que se olhar no espelho e perguntar é se você está fazendo isso do seu trabalho, se está fazendo isso da sua vida.
The role of the urban architect is to make cities more human. I think the question you should ask when you look at the mirror is whether you are doing that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jelson. Our next speaker is Gayatri Chakravorty Spivak. She is a university professor here at Columbia, and her institutional interest is to create communication lines between humanities and professional schools like architecture, law, and area studies and the social sciences. In relation to architecture, her publications include Excelsior, Hotel Coffee Shop, from Assemblage 20, and City-Country Agency in the Vikramaditya Prakash edition. She has also contributed to the first issue of Grey Room in an article titled Theaters of Decolonization and the Megacity. Thank you so much for joining us today, and please welcome Gayatri Spivak.
Hello, this is not really a photograph. You keep it there, okay? This is not a photograph that I'm going to use, so it'll be good. You don't it's my friend Abiola Irele taking a prize. Let him be there, he doesn't belong there. When I need Gavin, when I need, then I'll tell you what I need, and then we'll move from old Biola, okay? All right, great. So now I am a teacher of the humanities, right? So I cannot romanticize the informal. I started as an assistant professor in fall 1965. We worked that one to death in the 60s, both in the United States and in France. It was a mistake. So what I will say is that I'm not doing field work with these people. I am not spending time with them. I was not born among them, but just as after 24 years at Columbia, I teach there as I teach here, right? And after 24 years in New York, I'm a New Yorker, I wasn't born here, but I teach my students here in the same way. I wasn't born among the landless illiterate, but after 30 years, I'm also a villager. So please keep in mind that I teach them, all right? I'm not, we cannot just say, a humanities teacher. I'm not saying architects should be like humanities teachers, but humanities teachers can't be like architects. So it's a bit of a boring talk, but, you know, there you are. Your topic is urban informality in different cultural contexts through the lens of housing. And your title is Housing the Majority. My idea of, quote, majority, as a teacher of the humanities, is the largest sector of the electorate in places like continental Africa and India. As such, I am not directly involved with sub-proletarian urban housing, but rather with the landless, illiterate, rural population of India, and thank you, Reinhold, for mentioning that fact, the rural kind of determining the urban, and in fact, I do work in Nigeria, and I wish I had the time to talk about oil and the disappearance of primary production, and then how, in fact, Nigerians are trying to revert that, but there's no time for that. Okay. The urban is, so as such, I'm involved with the landless illiterate rural population of India and the urban-rural interface in Nigeria with Reinhold. The urban is determined by the volatility of the rural. In the Indian context, the subaltern built clay houses, the government provides cheap latrines, not much in demand. And I'll tell you, the picture of the latrine was sent to me this morning by a guy who still shits in the woods, but also is slowly learning. He's one of my co-workers, Dhananjay Lohar. He had never sent an email in his life before, but he had told me that there was someone's smartphone there where he had seen me talking on YouTube. And so I realized that I might call on him. So I said to him, look, this is how. And so he got on his motorbike and he went and took the photo and he sent it to me this morning. I said, listen, in 3 hours, because I'm talking in 7 hours. Of course, it was 3:30 in the afternoon in India. So that's my relationship with them. So at any rate, the urban is determined by the volatility of the rural. In the Indian context, the subaltern built clay houses. The government provides cheap latrines, not much in demand. My task is to rearrange desires uncoercively so that a desire to use latrines may be produced rather than uselessly imposed. Is this housing? In some ways it is, because the large projects of giving brick habitats to randomly selected villagers seem not to have anything to do with a sense of place. As for the corner of Africa that I quote know, the work by those with whom I'm allied is to rearrange desires uncoercively so that a return to the land becomes once more viable. I should mention here Alexandra Cook. I can't say anything more about her, student at Columbia. How does representation of informal places and their constituents affect political voice and agency, you have asked? Political voice and agency is the vote. I quote Derrida, reminding you that in French, voix means both voice and vote, and I quote him simply mischievously because you don't expect him to say anything like this. I quote, hence the calculation of units, that is, what are called voices or votes in democracy. How does one count? Because he's talking about democratic judgment in the largest sectors of the electorate. He's not talking about just counting, arithmetical reducibility of democracy. What are called voices or votes in democracy? How does one count? What should count as a unit of calculation? A question of nomos and thus of nemein, of distribution or of sharing. If everyone had rational judgment, we would not need democracy. I quote Marx, obviously. If everyone had rational judgment, we would not need democracy. Hence, one harnesses the humanities to rearrange the desires of the largest sector of the electorate of the important continents. And giving to, quote, informal the largest possible meaning, I quote myself, if, what is published prose, if one looked behind the international civil society into the decimation of the modern state and its transformation into management of capitalist globalization, with the sanction of the North in the South, informal markets would remain competitive within the ruling view of the world that can no longer think democracy. It makes its place within the contemporary disappearance of the democratic. Now, how does visibility create opportunities for political change, you have also asked. Since an early essay, Can the Subaltern Speak?, about 30 years ago, more than that, my interest has been in the fact that there is never an effort at subject formation among the beneficiaries. I have recently defined, quote, development as, I quote myself again, the economic transition into the circuit of capital with insufficient attention to subject formation. In the classes of which I speak, there is no subject, a class in the social sense, I speak, there is no subject formation about housing, although the government has for some time now propagated in my area these brick habitat projects left to the building imagination of the locals. Now, yes, I do agree when you say reverentially they know what they want. Of course they do. But what they cannot want, because they have been millennially denied the right to intellectual labor, is how to fit what they want into a larger vision of the world. They cannot want it. And this actually reflects the aporia within democracy between liberty, for me, I know what I want, and equality for people dissimilar to myself, completely dissimilar. Now, the problem is that the other directed stuff has been completely imposed upon them millennially by the ruling classes. So this is a huge problem which cannot be made to disappear by just simply saying they know what they want. That is an elite kind of luxurious statement, and that's what I'm calling romanticizing the informal. Of course they do, but that's not enough. The housing materials are supposed to be given to the BPL, a creolized subaltern word, BPL, whose, quote, correct English meaning below the poverty level is neither known by them nor needed. Since I will speak of gender soon, I will give you an example of this creolization. Incidentally, an informal that determines the formal, of which I have written elsewhere, and I can't go into it now. When you are arranging your son's marriage, your EPL, above poverty level, says Ujjal Lohar, a local, 7 years of education. In other words, mine is a well-off family, give a big dowry. When you're arranging your daughter's marriage, Ujjal continues, your BPL. In other words, we can't give too much of a dowry, forgive us. Creolized, lexicalized into the local. The brick habitat cannot, of course, be given to the real BPL, who are barely alive. So an artificial BPL favored by the party in power gets housing, and here is the visible. So can I go to the first set that I sent from 1 to 6 slowly? Okay, this is actually not the one that I want first, so go to the next one. This is my female teacher, but we'll come to her. This is also not, this is the first one that I sent. This is the first one I sent you in the morning, called GSAPP 15 or something. This one I just sent you. Yes, there you are. There you are. Okay, so this one, you see what's happening is this guy, he knows what he wants. He's building his house. This guy's building his house, and he's going to build a rush ceiling so that the heat will not be oppressive. But he has also got one of those government habitat thingies, right? So the brick is right there, and he's going to build a horrifying house in which he will not be able to live because it'll have a flat roof, and it'll be like a boiling cauldron. And anyway, go to the next one. See, this is my room. It's also brick. And you see, the idea, although I have told them, but, you know, telling, consciousness raising doesn't work. The idea that windows, I mean, because the other thing that you saw, there are no windows there, right? This kind of windows, that you have to have latches so that windows don't fall in that fierce wind in the lower reaches of the Himalayas, that's not understood. So you see those bricks? And otherwise, they make a horrible noise. You can't sleep or anything. Next. Same thing, next. Same thing, next. This is just my room. And you see, the doors have the same thing. They kind of totally bang, so my backpack is holding it back. I'm sorry about the quality of the things. There's no electricity. Next one. So you see, this is a very bad picture. Why? Because the idea that latches should latch is not there yet. So I have to put that bamboo pole across the door at night so that the dogs don't get in. So you see, the idea of being able to use the damn brick stuff that's being given to them according to their wishes, nobody teaches them anything. For a teacher, this is really an absurd and wasteful idea. So the rest of my remarks are made in the understanding that, is there another one on that? Ah, yes, we'll come to that. You can hold that. The rest of my remarks are made in the understanding that in building the house, we house the body. We house the body, hence latrines. They are offered by the government, but not used. A planning commission lady made a widely shared joke, uncomprehending. This was the joke. We offered them latrines or cell phones, and they took cell phones. Class difference speaking here. Now, let's look at the latrine. That's the next one from this. There we go. This is the one that Nanandar Lohar sent me this morning. Here's a photo of one set right in the middle of the fields, a few hundred yards from one of my schools, but when the child wants to be excused, he or she goes in the fields. They must want a variety of consumerism based on preventive health desire, much harder to produce, except disease by disease, effectively, an attitude of preventive health rather than dying early. Okay, here is my best teacher, the previous one, please. Here is my best teacher in the red sari. She now uses the latrine attached to my room with an outside door in my absence. I don't know when exactly this happened. And how did she respond a few years ago? In answer, I quote a paragraph I have given in Beijing, Berkeley, Delhi, Milan, and New York. Our class, again, I don't mean school class, but in the Marxist sense, our class reaction to it is embarrassment. Many questions were asked about many parts of this talk called situating feminisms, but never was this paragraph touched. I quote, a man walks with the feminist leader down a path strewn with human waste and says with ill-concealed pride, our toilets are free. When his mother is afflicted with cholera, a male co-worker's son with hepatitis, and since for lack of education, the man and the co-worker cannot use the free National Health Service, although the feminist leader can, it is possible for her to show by explaining the difficult prose of the World Health Organization into the regional language that they are paying the price of their free toilets and will continue to do so. When a woman, this one, a capable teacher who regularly teaches the books in the state curriculum outlining oral fecal disease is asked why she doesn't use the toilet, 2,800 rupees, paid for by the feminist leader for her own use, why she doesn't use the toilet added to her dwelling, she remarks, the men here are very courteous. They do not go near the fields which they know are being used by women for defecating. Now, this is a different kind of argument. Gender solidarity through acknowledgement of gender division of bodily affect. This is not a question of obeying hygienic principles. In the feminist leader's case, this has been rearranged through the use of caste shame by class mobilization through relatively recent European colonization. Is she simply interested in creating a, quote, middle class through the use of caste obedience? Then let's not accuse the elitists. This is not pre-modern to modern on the way to the postmodern. This is an acknowledgement of the relief map of modernity, calling for epistemological activism, humanities teaching, leading towards slow but real changes, supplementing necessarily feudal problem-solving, nice housing, necessarily feudal problem, however much you kind of join with them and dance with them, you don't go back there. Necessarily feudal problem-solving through learning to learn from below. I had just heard a brilliant paper by a Dr. Bini B.S. in Baroda on the caste distribution of shame in the context of the women's Channa rebellion and other related resistances in Kerala, and heard her lengthily lectured by a male Delhi University historian because she had dared to cite Foucault. She's an epistemological activist for the historiographers, and I hope I will learn more from her in the future. Last page. In the caste Hindu marriage, Lajjaharan, or the removal of shame, is one mark of being married. When the feminist leader strips in the Euro-US gym locker room, she is married to colonial history through the rearrangement of caste shame, which was harnessed to a modernity sequentially and teleologically computed so that she can lead today. Yet that is still employing a sexual difference that doesn't acknowledge the plurality of genders. If there are unisex or gender diversified locker rooms somewhere in the world, the female leader does not know it. And we notice that as the problem gets relocated by caste to race and class shift, we approach a reduction to absurdity. It announces the rupture into post-feminism. Child marriage is illegal in India. After many failed attempts to stop it in my area, I finally hit upon giving the instance of not breeding the calves too soon, and asking, do you want your daughter's body to be used too soon? I'm getting a measure of success. This is pre-theoretical practice of post-humanism, not liberal biopolitics, as Jadwir Puar commented in Good Faith when I suggested that other people's children, as a formula for democracy, can move from elite to subaltern. I just have half a page, it's 00, okay. Shall I call this a strategic use of essentialism on behalf of the subaltern? Do I, should I care? Or should I go high theoretical and ask, that we think the child as absolute event without compromising reproductive rights or human beings' right to choose. The first is unconditional, like justice. The second, an important condition, like law. Here, in this room, all we have to remember is that the gendered epistemic body it is, the gendered epistemic body that is housed. Within our class, art and medical discourse can broach the excreting body. So Yeats could write, love has pitched its mansion in the place of excrement. Without subject formation, we are obliged to say, rape has pitched its mansion in the place of excrement. No time to comment on this, but please remember this. And medical discourse can say it. There is now, here and there, a discussion of developing the mindset of latrine users in medical discourse, though I haven't seen Indian sources. Architecture housing the majority must become interdisciplinary here. This is a profound epistemic change. How to know your body as an object and involved with developing a preventive attitude toward health, of which I have already spoken. I cut some. Now, I just want to show that last picture and then move on. The last picture of this office in the new thing. In the new stuff that I sent, there's a picture called office building. New one that I just sent from the other room, called Pakistan. Okay, now I'll read on. For the moment, the only epistemic rearrangement of the desiring body is in the disregard for the living body used in the extreme response in the millennial discourse of the Christian subduing of Byzantium, of which the latest episode is the Khilafat movement, by an excessive physical violence, including the teaching of children, in the attempt to rewrite, not this, it's called office, go up, in the attempt to rewrite the map of the Middle East, matching the serene historical-cultural violence of the Sykes-Picot. It's a house. Okay, let me read that sentence again. It's a house, not people sitting down in the thing. Keep moving. Go up. No, there is a house in there. Just keep moving up, dear. There, that's the one. Okay, all right, I'll just say about this, that it's a picture depicting our office building, because I sent just the bad pictures. Previously, I sent this picture, I'll read very fast, sent this picture to Clive Vandenberg, a world-famous architect and artist, and wrote as follows. I'm attaching here a picture of our office building, which was built entirely by these very poor landless people on interest-free loans from me, which they immediately repaid by taking salary cuts. So in other words, no capital involved. It's a comfortable place with enough room for a seminar, a hard bed, an attached bathroom with non-flushing toilet and a room for the workers to sleep. It has got a rush ceiling inside, so to escape the cold in winter and the heat in summer. I thought it would amuse you, I wrote to him, to see this modest functional structure where I had slept, for example, on the 19th. The tree outside was planted in memory of Wangari Maathai. It is my signature, I wrote, available only to myself, a bokul tree which grows sturdy and big but also has flowers, and a wonderful Bangladeshi poet, ecological worker, intellectual Farhad Mazahar, was kind enough to write a small collection of poems about me, comparing me to this tree. So my signature, get it? And he responded, I'm looking at the picture of the building with your signature planted outside and thinking how much I love modest buildings. I also love trees, so the idea of such a signature is the best kind of spatial marking, last paragraph. For the moment, the only epistemic rearrangement of the desiring body is in the disregard for the living body used in the extreme response in the millennial discourse of the Christian subduing of Byzantium, of which the latest episode is the new Khilafat movement by an excessive physical violence, including the teaching of children, in the attempt to rewrite the map of the Middle East, matching the serene historical-cultural violence of the Sykes-Picot. Two chief agenda items, the destruction of ancient built space and the gendered epistemic body. And in through that destruction of ancient built space, one I can go into a favorite argument of mine that all built space via Benjamin moves toward ruins, but not the buildings that I've spoken of. These remarks then have been a humanities teacher's exhortation to see the volatile rural as determining the urban and to consider that the gendered epistemic body is what is housed. If there is anyone from the ICLS Graduate Student Conference present here, let me say that this is also a response to the series of quick abstractions, glib and quick abstractions about the body that I heard there. Thank you for giving me extra time.
Thank you. Now I'd like to invite all of the speakers from the panel to join us at the table, and also to invite Hilary Semple, who will be the main respondent for this panel. She's an architect and co-founder with Michael Meredith of MOS, M-O-S, an internationally recognized architecture practice here in New York City. It has also been the recipient of the Wholesome Award and named an emerging voice from the Architectural League here in New York. Their work is held in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art, the Art Institute in Chicago, and Yale Art Gallery. She is currently an associate professor here at Columbia University's GSAPP and the director of the CORE and the coordinator of the Housing CORE 3 studios here at GSAPP. Thank you for joining us.
Wow. Extraordinary presentations, and nice to meet everyone. Thank you for your presentations, and I think also just wanted to say how much I've been looking forward to this conference, and I think just to note the importance of having all the studio X directors here and the relationship of what happens in the architecture program to the architecture studios and Studio X. And I think we've been working really hard to kind of build this interest in a kind of global practice, but global teaching also. And for myself personally, teaching and leading the housing studio for the Masters of Architecture program, and then teaching advanced studios where I've worked with EMPO and also Pedro in Johannesburg and in Rio, and this semester working on Rio de Padres, Flavela in Rio. So the subject of representation, I think we have amazing presentations, all incredibly different, let's say. So how we can begin to find common ground, if that is even, or why that might even be something to try to figure out. But I think in the kind of question of how do we understand representation today, how do we understand the city? How do we understand housing in relationship to those three things? I'm sorry, I have taken many notes from this. I think one of the things that's most important to talk about is, I think, our understanding of what housing is for the majority, particularly this relationship and understanding between architecture and the city, and then architecture and housing, especially, that it is... I think this kind of question of, let's say, why even study the favela is, I think, what I think Alfredo for sure you presented and Gelson in that the favela is this place not of a kind of pain, let's say. Of course, there's that. If we think of these notions, and Alfredo, you certainly started with this. I think one of your first sentences, you started to explain this idea of the made, and certainly you're making things in those contexts. But this idea that the world is, I would say, in the way Elaine Scarry presents it, in the body of pain, but these conditions of always being made and unmade. And I think that's something that each of your presentations shares. And the representation of those things, and that we're always in this perpetual state of making and unmaking the world. I mean, not necessarily maybe personally, but as I can only speak as an architect, but being confronted with those conditions, that things are made, and often as an architect, these things that we make, but we are in conditions also of unmaking. We're responding to things maybe being unmade. I think also that today we're in a moment where we have to respond. We can't sit back, let's say, in our own kind of autonomous place as a discipline that maybe we once were, which I think is exciting in many ways, that we're searching for new narratives. And I would say that in each of your presentations, you presented that in different forms. And that those new narratives also then produce new audiences. I feel that the students are, again, speaking of the architecture students, and speaking maybe through the program of Columbia, that is both, I think, seeking to be actively engaged in the global, but also cosmopolitan, and to define what that means in relationship to a practice of architecture. But that the projects, in a way, you know, if we were to sort of simply go back to the very basic of what representation means, as a kind of lens through a kind of practice in architecture school. So very simply to say, you know, Alfredo, for instance, you present us images, you present us drawings, and then you present a building, a house, a kind of small scale domestic house that's in a way it's individual and personal, but yet it also becomes very public in the nature of your work. And I think that's a kind of shift that could be acknowledged. I just go through a couple of points that I sort of observed, and then I think Ramin, in your films, which are extraordinary, and I really appreciate the, you know, the kind of emphasis to, in a way, uncover a kind of other, something that, you know, that for instance, in the case of the pushcart, you're looking to reveal something to us that we wouldn't normally see, as you're saying. But that the city has produced this. I mean, it's not dissimilar to, let's say, a kind of late 1800s London street sweeper or the window washer, right? That is a kind of product of architecture. Although, you know, Corbusier drew in the window washer in his drawings, right? And so I think this the kind of, in all of the presentations, the relationship of the body, the image of the body, that I think probably within architecture schools, I would say this is a the collective of the presentations together, the most bodies we see presented that image of the body. And so even to think then through the kind of nature of photography, that the photographer and the photographs themselves produce a new representation and produce new narratives that can be responded to. And lastly, I think, in the case of your presentation, both in the images, these kind of site photos that you took yourself, but describing in a way the importance of rearranging desires, and whose desires to be rearranged, and then what that then represents. Even and through the kind of introduction of YouTube in your discussion is an interesting one to start to think of. But and the relationship, of course, of in this case, as you described, the kind of gender body and the kind of housing of that. And I think the last thing, of course, that we could talk about linking all of these is this notion of interdisciplinary, which you brought up, and how that ultimately relates to representation. So these are more maybe observations, but trying to find a kind of thread that I think ultimately is above and beyond housing, but more so our reaction to how we read the city and what the city means today. Because it seems to me that of all these places, they are linked more closely to one another than they are different. And maybe that's a kind of point of debate or to open that up. I don't have a specific question, but a kind of more observation about that and the sort of importance of just even thinking through these problems of making versus unmaking the world, because they're not, did you want to?
Parece-me que o ponto comum que existe entre nossas apresentações é o reconhecimento de que, além da disputa política, da disputa ética, da disputa econômica, existe uma disputa estética que a favela coloca para a cidade.
It seems to me that the common point of our presentations is the recognition that, in addition to the political, the ethic and the economical disputes, there's also the aesthetic dispute.
Os moradores da favela produzem uma estética que tradicionalmente não é visibilizada nem é reconhecida.
Favela residents produce a kind of aesthetic that is normally not recognized or not seen.
Por isso que muitas vezes a gente não reconhece beleza na favela.
That's why many times we do not recognize beauty in favelas.
Não reconhece as regras.
We do not recognize the rules.
Ou novas formas de regulação.
Or new forms of regulation.
Então me parece que o princípio que todos nós tentamos mostrar é que existe complexidade, riqueza estética e subjetividade nas experiências dos pobres e nas experiências das moradoras de periferias e favelas.
So the principle that we all try to show is that there's complexity, there's richness, there is aesthetics, and there's subjectivity in the lives of poor people, in the people who live in the periphery and in favelas.
E muitas vezes políticas públicas e os urbanistas tendem só a ver aspectos objetivos das favelas e não essas dimensões subjetivas que são fundamentais para construir o direito pleno das pessoas à cidade.
And many times public policies and urbanists, they look at the concrete aspects of favelas and disregard the subjective dimensions.
Well, it's interesting, Hilary, that you...
Sorry, I didn't realize you had finished. I did not take the photographs. The photographs were taken by... I don't have a camera. They were taken by a guy called Shubhendu Mondol. I said gendered epistemic body, because bodies have minds. And the idea of just body is a great abstraction, and there I go with Nietzsche, because the body is just a place of encryption. Things happen inside, and they things twist, and we read them wrong, and we call them hunger, and we call them gotta pee, and so on and so forth. So therefore, I was that my real emphasis was on the gendered epistemic body. And the uncoercive rearrangement of desire, I've written a great deal on it. I'll try to make it. Now, the rearrangement, that is unfortunately the incredibly frightening responsibility of the humanities teacher, literature and philosophy. And if you are a paid servant of the student, you got to try it. It's not psychoanalytic. That's why you got to know very, very, it's rough and ready. You got to know very well as you can each semester, the group with whom you're dealing. And so you kind of figure out some kind of a thumbnail skit of you may be wrong. That's the problem. Humanities teaching is incredibly dangerous if it's taken seriously rather than just playing around telling stories. So, and the uncoercion, all education has some violence in it. So that the uncoercion is in accepting the future anteriority that whatever is going to happen as a result of this is not going to resemble what you're doing. That's where that comes in. So I won't go on about it. I've just given a very long lecture at Oxford on this, and it'll be printed, and I'll send it to you. But that's what it is. Don't think, and the desires of the classroom here at Columbia, at the top and at the very bottom, they also have to be rearranged uncoercively. And I can't go into it because, as I say, I've talked about it a great deal. I think these are the two questions you asked me. But one thing that I will say is the object of investigation. When we make something our object, why study? When we make something our object of investigation, there is a great responsibility also in not simply separating ourselves from it as an unqualified sort of admirer. That's what I was trying to tell you. I mean, that's the desire. I mean, Reinhold and I have worked together for many years. That's, to an extent, the desire of architects that one tries to rearrange as a very old teacher. And the one thing that within architecture seems, I was just talking to Prem about this too, seems very absurd is the kind of pre-critical view of intentionality. I mean, I remember my friend Chumi taking me all over the place, or Peter Eisenman taking me all over the place, telling me this is what I'm doing in this building. And it was fantastic, but the Parthenon, Alfred Lerner. But what a view of intentionality that is. I intend this, here's the building, this is what the building does. Totally pre-critical. That's our problem. So that's when we make the object of investigation these wonderful informal places, that problem doesn't go away. So that's the end of my intervention for the moment.
Carry on. It's interesting that you...
yes.
that you talk about the body and we talk about respect and certain ethics, right? And that reminds me like the Renaissance, right? I mean, you had the medieval city and then Alberti and all
but
of them.
Not just the body, the epistemic body. Don't forget that word.
Learning every day.
Thank you. I mean, no one listens. Carry on.
So it just reminds me, it just occurs to me that, of course, and then Aldo Rossi, Architecture of the City, so we're back there, and he ends the chapter, actually, talking about that we must return to kind of the social body of the city, and he ends the book. And so here we're picking up again from the 60s. But what I want to say is that what we bring as architects, because we are in a school of architecture, and what we bring is our biographies and our logics. So the way in which we confront a project of architecture, confront the city, hopefully it's your city, the one you're living in, that you're working in. Traditionally, architects have worked in their cities. I mean, Le Corbusier was the first global architect, and now we have a great deal of them. But actually, I think that's the problem, that we've lost touch with that kind of immediate reality of our city, our biographies. So therefore, I changed and had to unlearn what I had been taught here at Columbia University, unfortunately, when I got down, because I thought I would build the city as with parametric designs and all kinds of wonderful images. And that's why the romanticization of images or aesthetics is very dangerous. Of course, in V.S. Naipaul tells a great story about simulacrum when he goes to the design school in Ahmedabad and he sees students trying to redesign the bullock cart without any notion, putting new wheels on it, new gears, new things, without understanding the economics of the wood bullock cart with just the tire, right? So we have to be really careful with that over-aestheticization. So what it takes me to say is that logic. So we design in our cities with our biographies, what we've learned, where we're coming from, and with our realities confront us in the face. You know, it could be if it was New York, I would certainly confront either the rising currents, or I would confront the Rockaways and all of that, or the Bronx, South Bronx, as Peter Marcuse has told us repeatedly, what are we doing traveling around the world doing projects, right? So in a sense, you confront what's most immediate to you because that's what you're going to know best, or that's how you're going to figure it out better. But with that, I want to just add, you need to adopt an ethical stance for environmental and social justice, and you need to foil, have that your plans, your mappings, your visualizations, your designs have to be a kind of embedded in the power structures and reverse them, the protocols, and maybe reorder the urban system that it's trying to shape. So it's reframing the discipline of architecture by not thinking of kind of just plopping down or master planning, etc., but actually inventing modes of practice in those productive margins and using your designs as a kind of activist entrepreneurial spirit.
Well said.
I was quite moved by all the speakers, but especially the Silvas, who's I really appreciate what you said, because my coming at it from a different perspective, which is more storytelling and more who are the people that are in these cities or homes or structures or environments. And something that always struck me was after Chop Shop was screened, there's a scene later in the film where the boy is doing all kinds of things, stealing things and whatnot. In one scene late in the film, he goes to the U.S. Open and he steals a purse from two women and their baby, and he just runs off. This was filmed in a live environment. We were very far away, so all kinds of people are doing nothing, or one person, two people tried to stop him. The boy was very good. He got away. I remember many people after the various screenings in different parts of the world or in emails through my website would tell me that they were glad the boy got away with stealing that. And I, of course, loved this ambiguity that suddenly, normally we would be very angry, why is he stealing? And suddenly everyone is very happy that this boy has stolen something. And I like this, the muddiness that this creates, and I thought it was somehow in my mind was connected to what you were saying about who are these people, what do they want, what are their stories, how do we see them, how do we perceive them. I think with 99 Homes, you know, everyone knows about the housing crisis. We've heard about how many people lost their home. We have an understanding about, I mean, 99 Homes, I told Joe Stieglitz I would name it for him and the 99%. Everyone has understanding of percentages of, 1% of the, even less now, 0.1% of the world's population controls half the world's wealth. These are all statistics, but when you can see people, I mean, someone up there said they were actually already crying seeing this old man being evicted. In terms of change, you know, you put it out there and you hope that someone will see these things, see these images, see these buildings, see the photographs, and that other people will become interested in things that they're normally not interested in and try to become a part of the process. And again, saying I think that you're right that we really need to hear the voice of the people who were there. I also like what you said, which is they may not always know what's correct. So I like that, the tension that...
They know what they want, but that is good.
Yeah.
There's more.
Yes, there's more.
I wanted to maybe just make a just share a couple of thoughts by borrowing some of the ideas and terms that were raised in the first panel, and I hope it's not cheating, by maybe borrowing something from David Sims's future panel, but from the abstract, and to try maybe and unpack it, even if just as a provocation. And it will also kind of try and follow up on the move towards the ruins, in a sense. So the move towards the ruins and speaking about representation. So when in the first panel we were, we learned about what you meant by auto-construction and its relationship with the ideal of the city, in a sense, we may also relate auto-construction to the auto-construction of imaginaries, and so auto-representation in a sense. And so if auto-representation is one of the things that we want to put on the table, and then also building on the idea of slumming. So if slumming is what representation does without being careful, so if we're actually saying that the representation of the outsider, so we've been talking about who is representing, and so if the representation of the outsider is actually producing that slumming process, so in the formalization of architecture, so when, for example, the bricks are being sent to those places, we're actually starting to move towards the ruin when the kind of auto-imaginary starting to be destroyed, in a sense. And so I wonder about the role of architecture and also about the very important place of the person representing, and not only that, being the person being represented. And I think the collapse between the documentary and the fiction, I think, is a really beautiful way of maybe kind of demonstrating that is so when the person representing is through the process of intentionality and the projection of what needs to be done in the slum is actually starting that move towards the ruin of that auto-constructed imaginary of the city. So what I'm suggesting is that maybe that toolkit of parts or the bricks are actually a move towards the ruin, and it's also something that's very dangerous for us to start even kind of thinking about as architects, because in the end, you know, unless we're only talking about this as an area of analysis, but if it's not only an area of analysis, like Madden suggested, then are we actually moving towards the ruin of, and then also what was suggested, the kind of accelerating that not yet that we were warned about, that total control of the city, in a sense, that we were warned about also by the first speaker today. So maybe, I don't know if anybody has any thoughts about that, or Rajiv, if you want to continue.
Well, I mean, maybe going a little bit on what Hillary was saying about this idea of the idea of making and unmaking, I mean, if you look at where, I mean, I think let's also understand the different contexts in which we all operate. I, you know, I'm from Mumbai, or I'm from New York, and I'm in Mumbai, so I lived in two different worlds, and I understand things from a certain perspective 15 years ago, and 15 years later, I understand the slum or the informal or the network as something very different. It's not something that's so analytical to me. It's something that is more present. It's more part of me in a way. It's an appendage. The city functions in that way. There's no way that it cannot. And if you look historically, I mean, if you really look at the history of a city like Mumbai, there was always something which controls probably every settlement or slum or informal situation in the world, which is always an axis between other powers, which then somehow use the slum or use this informality to achieve a certain goal. So the elite and the market, they converge to make something of a city on seven islands, and they do this, and what happens in between and all the filling, all the things that everything is built upon was the slum. The slum is what made that network. The slum was not necessarily about just physical form or urban form. It was about creating very, very specific necessities in a city, you know? So if we look at, you know, words or conceptual framework more as a way of understanding even architecture, form, representation, we look at unifying, inclusionary, social, community focus, sympathetic to culture of collectivity, networked, adaptive, assets, physical assets and social assets and psychological and, you know, emotional assets to the city, whether urban or rural, because they're both connected. I agree that you cannot separate both. But they also provide choice. They provide empowerment. They provide security. Infrastructure, not just hard infrastructure, of all these things like sanitation, which are important, but infrastructure of being able to, when you clear a slum, what happens when you, I think watching your film is very interesting, people so isolated in a very physical space don't suggest that I will move into the next door neighbor's house in a way, you know, but they actually, in a slum, when it's cleared, the people actually, the density of what's not cleared becomes increased, and those people move into those spaces.
So I just came from Silicon Valley. I've been going there a lot recently, and I just came from a place called The Jungle, which you may have read about. It's one of the largest homeless camps in the United States that's less than 15 minutes from
San Francisco.
Less than 15 minutes from Silicon Valley, actually. It's maybe a little bit farther to San Francisco, 30 minutes. Anyway, Atherton, the wealthiest zip code in the country, is 15 minutes away. Of course, no one in Silicon Valley knows about it. They're going to other places, as you said, to solve problems.
They pass on the buses that are going to Google and stuff, yeah.
Yes, I actually have no, I'm not sure I have a problem with the buses, because maybe there's something good in those buses, but they actually have no idea that it's there, and that the jungle was just cleared, and now those people are in different camps.
Yeah.
We then visited some homeless shelters and some other shelters, crisis control type shelters, and it was very interesting to see what happened to those people, how many of them started to actually come into the jungle because they were promised housing. But the displacement of those people is now, no one knows where they are. There was something positive about them all being in one place because it garnered visibility, press, people wanted to do something suddenly, but then they got bulldozered out. For me, it was just amazing that it happened just 10 minutes from the wealthiest zip code in the country.
So maybe I'll pick up on the ruin-making and remaking. So I agree, Nora. I mean, in a sense that once we introduce technology as bricks, we introduce new ideas into the cities, into these urban villages, it can create a lot of destruction. Okay, that's your point, right? So therefore, damned if you do or damned if you don't. Do you do it? Do you not? Do you try and advance some kind of, do you want to bring infrastructure? Do you want to bring water? Do you want to bring some kind of logic to economic vibrancy? So therefore, that's why I say again, we have to infiltrate
those other disciplines. So sometimes I feel I'm like a social worker. Other times I feel I'm like an entrepreneur. Other times I feel I'm, you know, an engineer, technocrat, right? Trying to figure out how the solar panel gets connected. So the architect actually has to step off that plinth, go back into relearning, going to the peripheries of our discipline, you know, actually, or the periphery of the core of the discipline, if you want, and where it engages with other disciplines and start to network. I mean, that's the great 21st century. We have the capacity to build incredible networked projects with people who are willing to collaborate. I mean, that's why industry is, that's why if there's any belief that you think that this is, again, the 19th century and that we will industrialize Mumbai and we will industrialize all the developing world countries and that be through labor and progress and work, that's not going to happen because the internet and a series of other fragmentation of industrialization is not going to create the workforce and the economic power.
No, they're not, because the factory floor was pulverized with post-Fordism already. You didn't need the internet. Yeah. But let me say one thing, that in terms of what we were talking about, it was not that we can now solve problems. But the other thing that one cannot forget is to try, a much more difficult task is to, because now it's easy with the internet network, this, that, we can do everything. Say you. But what I'm trying to talk about is to produce problem solvers so that the problems top down will not be solved so quickly, but we then decide that these kinds of problems solved will be, we can say about Corbusier that he didn't really know what the people who were going to use those buildings were going to do, and isn't that wonderful? But that's, that, you know, what applies to him applies to us. That's something that, that's a lesson that history teaches us. So that, you know, to solve, no, no, I want to say one more thing. And the idea of being ethical is not something that we think about, because doing the right thing, bringing electricity and water, very wonderful problem-solving things. I'm not saying no to that. I would be an idiot if I did so. But the ethical is unconditional. So you produce a situation where if that situation hits you, the reflex will kick in like a well-trained athlete. The athlete doesn't think, I'm now going to follow through. You see, the muscle memory responds. That's what you do when you teach to produce problem solvers. And the last thing is the ruins. Remember where it comes from in Benjamin. It's not just a colloquial word, ruins. They did not accept that dissertation. It was about the Baroque. It's the origin of the German Trauerspiel. The Baroque has eternity in it, but when you look at it conditionally, then it becomes on the way to ruins. And we don't introduce bricks. One of our etiologies is that Brihaspati made all these characters, the whatchamacallit, the animals, they ran away from him. He couldn't catch up with them, so he goes back to the holy fire with sweating, and the sweat falls into the fire. That's the first Brihaspati, and what he saw was a brick. It was a, that's one of our etiologies. So brick civilizations are not just today. So it's not that we are bringing in bricks. There have been built civilizations before, and those are the ones that are amenable to ruins, not just us bringing bricks to the poor favela dwellers.
So if I add to that, as we are architects in this audience primarily, I say the architect has to start to be the moderator and the glue between top-down policy and big infrastructure works, and the bottom-up education of actually local problem solvers. And so I saw very clearly in your photographs that you're working on that local level. And Hubert and I began in Caracas on that local level. That now we've shifted maybe in through ETH to try and now tackle the hierarchical top-down, and maybe we can find some connectivity, and that would be the ideal role. And that's why the profession suddenly profoundly is going to change. It's not just about form making. Okay. It's about rewriting the brief.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, we're out of time, and I think we're taking a five-minute break and to come back at 4 o'clock. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I now must go to sleep. So we're coming back at 4 o'clock.